got this life of being the sacrifice, well pleasing the temple, Lord, you can dwell. I love this life of being the sacrifice, well pleasing the temple, Lord. My Lord, Lord Jesus, Jesus, Lord Jesus, Father God, Father, oh God and Father. Holy Spirit, oh Spirit of the Lord. Oh, I love this life of being a sacrifice well pleasing, a temple, Lord, where you can dwell. Oh, I love this life. Sacrifice well pleasing, a temple, Lord, you can dwell. Jesus, Lord Jesus, oh Jesus Christ, my Lord, Father. Father and God, Father, God, oh Spirit, Holy Spirit, oh Spirit of the Lord, oh Jesus, Lord Jesus, oh Jesus Christ, my Lord, oh Father, my God and Father, oh Father God, Spirit. A sacrifice well pleasing, a temple of the Lord. Oh, I love this life of being a sacrifice well pleasing, a temple, Lord, where you can dwell. Hallelujah. Sacrifice well pleasing, a temple, Lord, where you can dwell. Jesus, Lord Jesus, oh Jesus Christ, my Lord, God and Father, oh. A loveless life would be a sacrifice well pleasing. A temple, Lord, where you can dwell. A loveless life would be a sacrifice well pleasing. A temple, Lord, where you. Lord Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, Father, God and Father, Father God to me, Spirit. Holy Spirit, O Spirit of the Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, Father. God and Father, your Father, God to me, Spirit, Holy Spirit, Spirit. Father, Father, your Father, God to me. Do that one more time. Father, God and Father. Father, God and Father, your Father, God to me. Do it one more time for the editor. A Father, God and Father, oh Father, God to me. Spirit, Holy Spirit, oh Spirit of the Lord. The verse. God. Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, God and Father, oh Father God to me. Spirit, Holy Spirit. Spirit of the Lord.
See the sun come like flashes of lightning. See the sun rise. See the sun come, clouds of glory. The rise of God in me.
This side of mine, this side.
Jesus, you my Savior. Jesus, you my Savior. You're my Savior. Jesus, you my Savior. Jesus, you my Savior.
Thank you.
Lord, you flood my soul. You flood my soul. You flood my soul with heaven.
Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. Ah, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Father, we praise your holy name. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for your glory that overwhelms us, Lord. We thank you for your power, oh God, that has taken hold of our lives. Father, we thank you that we're kept by you, strengthened by you, perfected by you, upheld by you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we lift up our voice and praise unto your name. She's not held. She's held. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I will praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Come praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, we'll praise you, Lord. Oh, God, we praise you now. Oh, Lord, we lift you up above everything, oh, God, that we could ever need. Oh, God, we praise you now. Oh, God, we praise you now, and Lord, we'll praise you throughout eternity. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your goodness. Holy Spirit, we ask you to take control of every person's life in this place, that there would not be one single person that would hold back even the slightest little bit from you. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven right now. This is not your house. This is Father's house. You're not in charge here. You have to go home to be in charge. God's invited you to come into the realms of his glory. If you want to, all are welcome, but you can't come your own way. There's a highway. God paved it with a wonderful love. God opened up the door to the veil of the flesh of Jesus. And I mean, listen, I don't believe there's any possible way for you and I to even enter into this realm without being stricken by the reality of all that he paid, all that he did, the sacrifice that he made, the pain that he suffered, the agony, the rejection, the turmoil, the upheaval. All that he went through. Listen, I'm tired of Christians getting in the way of the Holy Ghost. I'm tired of it now. You listen to me. You humble yourself before the living God. You have just a very short time to live. Very short time. Then you're going to find out a little bit more about what we've been talking about as soon as you step over on the other side. Reality of it is God's opened the door so everybody can find out now. I pray in the name of Jesus tonight that you will be willing to let the Spirit of the Lord touch you. I pray tonight that you'll let the Spirit of the Lord take you beyond yourself, beyond the realms of human thinking, beyond the realms of the human interaction into something so glorious, so divine. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, listen, I want you to be seated. I really, what God wants you to do more than anything else is He wants you to know and understand how to flow in the Holy Ghost. And He's amazing how wonderful He is, because He is so long-suffering. He just stays at it. He just stays with it. And it's still, until you begin to give yourself over to recognizing that you're living out your life in the presence of the Lord, you're going to forget till after the, till about the end of the meeting. And that's the way a lot of God's people have lived their life. They come into the meeting and they just forget. They forget that they're standing in the presence of God. They forget that the songs are about Him. They forget about what Father wants to do through those songs, through that worship. About the end of the meeting, it starts to, the lights start to come on. Oh yeah, that's right. I'm in the presence of the Lord. Father wants me to touch Him with my heart. He wants me to touch Him with my emotions and my passions. If you could leave here tonight just saying, you know what, I just love being the place that He's pleased to dwell, the living sacrifice that is acceptable and holy unto Him. And you begin to live out your life in the reality of what God has purposed to do with your life. Suddenly signs and wonders and miracles are going to begin to take place to you. I love that song. I love that song. It's such a precious song. It's a sacred song. It really is, because it's declaring the things that are in Father's hearts to do. Signs and wonders like have never been seen before. But He's got to have vessels, broken vessels to do it from. People are so high on themselves. I think it takes man a lifetime. And especially in the Western world where you've been taught to really be in control. You've been educated to trust in yourself, to compete. You've been educated to make your own decisions, to be the king of your own world. And none of that works in the culture of the kingdom. None of that works in the realms of the Holy Ghost. Everything that you've been taught in your education process and that you've learned from your peers and by those people that are important to you is completely opposite to how you move in the Holy Spirit. And so tonight, once again, we're going to labor again to just help present these things to you by the Holy Spirit so that you can understand all these things are available. All you have to do is be willing to receive. This communion, this fellowship with God is such a wonderful thing, because we get to, first and foremost, we get to live out an abundant life in a beautiful awareness, hallelujah, of how much He loves us, how He secures us, in this wonderful awareness that this just keeps getting better forever and ever. Hallelujah. One amen. There we go. Jesus. To be accepted in Christ Jesus, to be accepted in the Beloved, Christ Jesus. To have access with confidence by the faith of Him in the very presence of the Lord. Wow. To be able to be His representatives, His witnesses in this earth, to live out a life full of divine power and divine glory. What a blessing. I pray that you'll hunger for this more than anything else, because if you will, you can have it. You have to lose your life to have these things. And that's where people draw back. They don't want to lose their life. You come step in the presence of the Lord, you behold Him, you're like, I get to trade my life for what I'm looking at right now, what I'm seeing, what I'm experiencing right now. You mean, Lord, if I don't have my own wisdom anymore, I can have yours? And Lord, if I don't have my own understanding anymore, I can have yours? If I come to rely upon that which I have learned through an education process, through a life experience, how old are you? 30? 100? Even. There's no one here 100. Even that's just nothing. Compared to if I lay that aside, I can step into His wisdom. If I will learn how to trust and wholly trust and lean on Him, I can step into His knowledge and His understanding. We want these things to become real to you, because Father needs some witnesses in the earth.
Amen. Amen.
And they're available to anybody who's willing to go His way. And His way is to first foremost to come and learn how to be broken. He says, learn how to, he tells us to, he says, come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. And that goes against everything that you are and the way that you are expected to live in a everyday existence. And so if you participate with the world in an everyday human existence, you are yielding your members to just the very opposite of what you must do if you're going to follow the Holy Ghost and move in the things of the Spirit of the Lord. Now, if I can convince you of these things, because you've got a whole Bible, if I can begin to help you understand this, and it's not some kind of, you know, people just get all, they get all lost in the forest. Either way, say, go this path, get lost in the forest. Go this path, get lost in the forest. People, it's living out this wonderful wellspring, springing, rivers flowing, of His love, of His joy, of His peace, a spectacular realm of living. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the living God. Where it's Father takes us and causes us to excel above every one of our peers. I mean, as the psalmist said, I know more than all of my teachers. Why? Because he's walking in the fear of the Lord. He's walking in the awe of God because of his relationship and his fellowship with the Almighty. It is wonderful to have wisdom, wisdom that everybody sits around and goes, wait a minute, I never thought of that. No, it's a God thought. God thought something that man never thought of. Do you realize that?
Yes.
No man can raise the dead, but one who moves in the Spirit of the Lord can raise the dead. No man can open up the eyes of one who's born blind, but someone who knows how to move in the Spirit can open up the eyes of one who's born blind. No man can speak with all of his intelligence and declare a creative miracle of an organ, whether it's the organ to be able to hear or to smell or to taste, or whether it's the organ of the heart or the liver or the pancreas or the kidneys, or whether the person's lame and their nervous system isn't working properly. Man who moves by the Spirit of the Lord can speak to those things and do the works of the Father. And suddenly, at that moment in time, humanity encounters a realm that is beyond them. Men begin to confront truth. Men begin to confront reality. Right now, all these other things are just lies. God, the Holy Spirit, He's the Spirit of truth. He bears witness in the earth. Right now, He also bears witness in heaven. He's the Spirit of truth. Outside of Him, it's just lies. It's lies. You say, well, is it really lies if I put gas or diesel in my automobile and my automobile runs off of that? No, it's not. But the reality of it is, that is something that is fully encapsulated within the framework of a temporal world that serves the interests of men. And by and large, those interests are nothing but lies. Unless you've been redeemed, born of the Spirit, filled, hallelujah, filled with the Holy Ghost, walking this out with the Father. I want you to open your Bibles tonight with me to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 10. Hallelujah. You guys could come sit down with me. I'm believing that tonight that you will allow the Spirit of the Lord to create within you a divine eruption. I pray tonight that you will actually allow the Spirit of the Lord to show you what all He's placed on the inside of you. To show you, you allow the Spirit of the Lord. He'll do it. He's here to do it. You have to allow Him. There are things that He will require of you to be able to get the miracle through to you. You know, usually every time the Lord was ever confronting someone, there was always going to be a price they had to pay, a risk they had to take. They had to do things that didn't make any sense to them, but God demanded it. The woman who was about to have, of Zarephath, who was about to have her last meal and die, the prophet of the Lord, who she didn't know from anybody else, she didn't know who this guy was, crazy or not, wild or whatever, she didn't know. He just looked at her and said, "You give to me first." Obviously, the word of God went forth under the realms of the anointing. It sparked something on the inside of her. It ignited something on the inside of her that caused her to respond. Somehow, she was willing to take the risk. I don't know how.
is like seemingly a very few people are willing to take these risks. I mean, people are dying all around in Israel. People are starving all around. I wonder if Elijah could have gone to anyone in Israel and said, you feed me first, and had a response. Maybe he couldn't have. You know, we know that there was a number of people that God had reserved, a remnant God had reserved in Israel. But during the times of Elijah, Israel was very, very wicked, is in a state where they believed that they were walking with God, and they believed they were serving God, but it just didn't line up with his word. Much like today, they're going to the house of God, they were doing all their sacrifices, going through all their rituals, but their lives did not line up with God. Elijah's did. Yes. Elijah's life lined up with God. He wasn't able to go and find anyone who was willing to take a risk in Israel. Jesus referred to it. He wasn't willing to find someone who could hear the word and move with faith. People sit around, they critically analyze things. What happens is every point in every juncture in your life that you critically analyze things, you are actually preserving your own life. You are. You're either preserving your own life, or somehow you're being influenced by demonic powers that want to cause you to function in the pride of life. Did you know that I believe that it is the scripture shows us that it is, it shouldn't be, that the pride of life is the one realm of demonic activity that the majority of people cannot, that are in church, that are Christians, that have been born again, cannot recognize nor discern. Before you ever going to be able to discern that realm, you're going to have to spend some time fasting and praying, learning a little bit about brokenness and lowliness. You've got to learn how not to rely upon yourself. You'll learn how to hate your life in this world first. And that's not something that a lot of people really developed in their spirit. They've not really developed that. I mean, they feel bad about themselves, but they're always, you know, feeling bad about themselves in the context that they feel great about themselves. And that's kind of a little bit hard to understand, but you know, you only feel bad about yourself because you put yourself in such a lofty position. You know what I'm saying? A person not in a lofty position never feels bad at all about themselves. You understand? A person who's not in a lofty position has no problem being servant of all and esteeming everybody better than themselves. That's a servant of all. And God, the Holy Spirit, is beckoning us to come. Why? Because he wants to teach us how to move in the realms of heaven. He wants to teach us how to move with the Holy Ghost. Because until we begin to move with the Holy Spirit, Jesus is never going to be revealed. Father is never going to be revealed. The things that Father's purpose to happen right here in this church tonight, that he's purpose to happen in the communities that you live in, or the workplaces that you go to, in the places where you shop and you do your everyday business, where people would recognize you, where you go banking, you know. I wonder how many people in this place where you bank, that they know that you are baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire and are equipped by the power of God to set them free from every stronghold of Satan so that they can make heaven. I wonder, you know, because so many times we live dualistic lives. We rationalize it. We say, well, they wouldn't be interested. It doesn't matter. Well, you know what? That is absolutely debunked in the first place by the scripture, because the Father doesn't in any way predicate our witness based on whether or not we think somebody is interested. It's walking in the framework of a human interest, human mind, human thinking. Why? Because you've spent your life developing your own personality, your own spirit, your own ideas of things, your own, in total, self-interest. God, the Holy Ghost, is calling us to come over to a place to deny ourselves. And the only way we're going to ever learn that is we're going to have to come to the Holy Spirit, and we're going to have to let him teach us how to walk in lowliness and meekness. We're going to have to make humility and brokenness something far more valuable and important than it's ever been in our life. And then as you do, you're going to understand, wait a minute, there's a lot of ways that I think, a lot of ways that I interact with people. There's a lot of response mechanisms, a lot of gestures on my face and my demeanor that just is really all about my own self-interest. Really what the Lord wants to do is he wants to take our lives and become literally a weapon of his righteousness, our tongue, a quill of the Father, the ink, the Holy Spirit. He wants to, with our lives, write the pages of his will so everybody can read it, right? The pages of his love so everybody can read it. Write the pages of his life so everybody can read it. Hallelujah, because it's written upon the tables of our heart and seen in the expressions of our face. Hallelujah. This is what Papa wants to do. He labors to do it. He earnestly labors with it. I pray that you'll come on Friday night and be a part of Friday night's School of Spirit, because I really want to help you understand how that getting you over into a place of depriving yourself of food and depriving yourself of all the things that you heap upon yourself will really help you to step back and look at you. You're not going to earn anything with God fasting and praying. What fasting and praying does is help you to stop and think, wait a minute, my life is very frail and fragile, and there's a whole lot more going on here than what I've understood. This is a bigger picture than me feeding myself, buffeting my body, taking care of all of my own interest. And reality, think about it, how much of our life is consumed with us pampering ourselves, bathing ourselves, taking care of ourselves. And when I'm saying bathing, I'm not talking about, you know, bathing in water. I'm just talking about bathing ourselves with all of these things that it's all about us. And it's not that the Lord doesn't want us to be well kept and taken care of. He does. It's just reality of it is the whole premise behind that is self-service. The whole premise is it's all about me. You can never move in faith. You are compromised with you. You're compromised with your emotions. You're compromised with your fear of men. You're compromised with all of the plethora of things that belong to a human realm. And Father's begging us, will we please quit acting like mere men? Will someplace, sometime, there be somebody who will stand with him that won't just be carnal, babes in Christ, just ordinary, everyday, run-of-the-mill religious folk? This is true. God is pleading with us. And the proper response is to say, okay, I want to come and be taught of you, Holy Spirit. I want to begin at the very beginning. The very beginning is where now I'm going to be willing to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and allow my life to be patterned after his and get wrong thinking out of the way. Because where that begins is where we take no reputation unto ourselves, where we humble ourselves as servants, where we begin now to give ourselves over to the Holy Spirit to teach us lowliness and meekness, to where we come to a place where we do nothing of ourselves, where all that we do is what Father says, all that we're devoted to only speaking the mind of the Spirit. Because it's fine to be quiet. It's fine not to say anything until God the Holy Ghost speaks. And I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to be speaking a whole lot when you shut up. When you quiet down, you're going to discover a whole lot of comfort, a whole lot of encouragement, a whole lot of prophecy, a whole lot of, you know, glorious things. I mean, Christ Jesus, the Son, comes like the lightnings. He comes like the clouds of heaven. Hallelujah. He rises as the sun comes with healing in his wings. I mean, it's just Papa's got some interesting things to begin to do with your life. I mean, I was looking at my wife the other day. She come walk in the living room. She just lit up. I was looking at her. I looked at her. I didn't say anything to her. I just looked at her, kind of a bit shocked, because I'm just sitting there being, you know, just kind of a little bit. I was just extremely tired on Monday. I was just being a little bit dead ahead, just, you know, working on the temple. I'm building the temple right now. I'm building the third millennial temple. I mean, the third temple that's going to be in the millennial, third millennial temple. I'm building a third temple of the millennial reign of Christ where a lot of good, wonderful things going on. But she comes walking by me, and her face just glowing with the presence of the Lord. And I know that Father wants to do that so much more. But if you were around her, there's a number of things you would begin to notice about her. She's walking around constantly with the Word of God playing on her little iPhone, her headset or whatever. The Word of God's always going on in the house, and she's very busy. She stays busy all day long. I don't know. I guess I'm the last child. I'm the child that never leaves home. I didn't think I was going to be, you know, that difficult to keep up with, but she's constantly just moving. And at any rate, and you're going to always find this willingness, you're going to find this servitude, you're going to find this posture of love, you're going to find this place where somebody gave themselves to being developed in the nature of Jesus Christ, in the nature of the Father. It's very different. We don't believe in servant of all. Well, we like to sing that, and we like to imagine that, and maybe a foot washing every once in a while, once every 5 years, something like that. No, it's just what it comes down to. We don't understand the value of it and the price of it. We don't understand it. We are busy with our own stuff, and you don't know how pressed I am, and you don't know how much I've got on my schedule, and you don't realize what a sacrifice it is for me to even be sitting here right now listening to you tell me all of these things that I need to do differently. And that is many people's response. Many people's response. And that's where you're stuck. It's just so sad. And then we're going to go praying, oh, believe God's going to use us in signs, wonders, miracles. He's not until we're willing to become childlike and just, you know, get really confident and bold with God. You know, the people that flow in the gifts of the Spirit and begin to move in the things of the Spirit of God, they just become confident and bold of God. Bold. They're just bold. You know, I think the educational system teaches you how not to be bold, how to be conservative with all of your thinking, how to go to some expert, to rely upon some man, to come under the auspices of the control of other people and what everybody else thinks. And you're locked into a prison, and God wants to break you out of that. He wants to give you a confidence and boldness that you can, you know, we're going to lay hands on you, you're going to get healed. I'm going to give you a word of knowledge. We're going to do signs and wonders and miracles. And, you know, there's just that creativity in the Holy Ghost. God is a creator. And he puts that on the inside of us. He doesn't tie us up and restrain us. Hallelujah. I pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you get over here in the liberty and get out of the prison and start enjoying the glorious freedom of what it means to walk with God, the Holy Spirit, to live by him, to rely upon him, to be under his control, to walk in the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit, to live by the Spirit, to walk in the Holy Ghost, to live in the Holy Ghost, to be led by the Holy Ghost, to speak by the Holy Ghost, to be consciously aware of saying, I'm going to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been privileged with an opportunity to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to me. I mean, I'm telling you, I'm dealing with a bunch of human thinking right now. It's so hard to get this. People just want to make it verses of scripture. They just want to socialize. Father loves his family, loves his people, but he certainly would like some people to start flowing in the signs and wonders and miracles, start moving in the glory of God, start enjoying the things of heaven, start being a representative of his glory in the earth, start doing what Father has purposed us to do. You're going to have to obey. You're going to have to come under the rule of God, the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to come under the rule of the Word instead of just pretend. Instead of just make believe, instead of just using the excuse that everybody uses, like the alcoholic on the street. Oh, I love the Lord so much. He loves me. He's never failed me. He's always with me. He answers most all my prayers. I have a very close relationship with him. I pray all the time. And he's staggering around, can barely even talk. From the drunkard on the street, all the way through. The various dispositions of men, you hear the same nonsense. And somebody's going to have to be done with the nonsense and into the evidence and into the proofs. Somebody's going to have to say, wait a minute, I don't have the proofs of God in my life, and I want to get them. And I'm going to go over some of the proofs here tonight because I want to emphasize things that Father has emphasized. And it's not proofs to make you feel bad. It's proofs to make you be glad, to hunger and go after God and say, wait a minute, this is what God's demanding of my life. I mean, you know, it's like you don't have to talk him into it. It's a command. He's demanding these things of your life. And he just wants to show us if they're not there, then there's things that have got to be changed. We've got to come under the rulership of the Holy Ghost. He's going to lead us and guide us. What a blessing that God, the Holy Ghost, has come to be our teacher, our leader, our guide, that we can come to know him in such a way that we can live out our life as a living sacrifice. That what you see going up here continually is the incense of heaven, the interaction with the communion of the Spirit. Our face begins to light up and shine with the presence and the glory glow of heaven. Hallelujah. Manzando robokishti apatalania pitufrete. Malazdadea prosto. Malangdalea prasisto. Havradistisist. Hambrabalastu tu preveya. It's like, it's just crazy, you know, it's crazy. Father starts to give us a little bit of favor and it goes right to our head and we shut everything down. Gives a little bit of attention, a little bit of recognition, and we go completely deceived with it and stop it all. Instead of going, being amazed of the movings of God that just break us and cause us to fall to our knees. People, there's got to be a different kind of response. And so tonight, I'm moving in the Holy Ghost, I'm moving in faith, that in your life would be created a different response because you become that much more conscious and aware of what God is saying, what God is doing, and that you're willing to imitate God.
Yes.
Huh? Amen. You're willing to imitate God. Quit playing pretend. You know, fake holiness. You know, just pretend, going through the drills, but not allowing it to be a reality in your heart that brings you to that place that Father expresses to us as the servant of all. Hallelujah. I mean, that's what lowliness and meekness is going to do for you. It's just going to make you a servant. A servant is going to give you a very joyful disposition in every situation. You're not going to feel slighted if somebody doesn't praise you today. You're not going to feel somehow like you're not really cared for and appreciated if somebody doesn't promote you to a higher position. All of that stuff becomes irrelevant. Jesus says that's what the Gentiles do. They make each other lords over each other, you know. That's not what we do. What we do is we serve. Anybody who wants to be greatest in the kingdom of God is going to become the servant of all. And so if you tonight you want to begin to flow in the nature and the power of the living God, then you're going to have to be willing to say, okay, Holy Spirit, I'm your candidate right here. I want to learn how to be servant of all. I want to learn how to do this with joy. I'm not walking around feeling like, oh, you know, I'm just a welcome mat, wipe your feet on me. No, I'm really love this. I love this because it's the very spirit of the living God. It's the place of love. It's the place of His manifest glory. It's the place of His manifest presence. It's not something that I'm having to do out of obligation. Once again, that's just nothing more than religion. God, the Holy Spirit, comes and gives us the motivation, the empowerment, the insight, the revelation. Well, this is life. This is life. I love life. This is life. Praise God, this is life. And so open your Bibles, and I'm going to show you a verse of Scripture that you probably read wrong all your life. So you've got to read it right tonight. Because what we do is many times we read the verses, we read the Bible to suit ourselves. We read the Bible so that we feel good about ourselves. And that's you need to get rid of them glasses. Throw them off your face, stomp them off the ground, say, I'm not putting those things back on. I'm not going to get another prescription of that. Huh? You want to read the Word of God as it's indeed the Word of God, and it's demanding a change, something, a radical difference about your life. Hallelujah. Rather than saying, yeah, I got that. Yeah, check, 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 check. Well, if you got all the checks, then you got all the stuff. You got all the power. You got all the display of the glory of God. All the proofs are there in your life. Check, 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 right? And when that's not the case, you got to say, wait a minute. Perhaps I'm reading the Bible wrong. Perhaps I'm self-serving with the way that I'm reading the Bible rather than bowing the knee before the Master and allowing Him in every way to change me so that I can be conformed, changed by the Word of God. Where I hear the Word of God come to me, say to me, I want you to stop doing that and I want you to do this. And we go, yes, rather than say, I am doing that. Because that was the response of a backslidden Israel again and again. And it's the response of the church today. Because it doesn't matter where you go, everybody's right. The Mormons are right. The Jehovah's Witnesses are right. The Baptists are right. The Baptists can't believe how much false doctrine you have. You can't believe how much false doctrine they have. The Roman Catholics are superior to everybody. They're right, more right than everyone else. And it goes on. And everybody's pointing fingers. And everybody's got all these things to say. But where is the life and the proof that Jesus demands? And that's what I'm going to go into. And I'm going to have to put it on you like this. What makes you any different from any other religious Christian? Period. I'm going to challenge you. What makes your worship, your fellowship, your knowledge, your interactions, your expressions anything different than any other religious person? What makes your church service anything that looks like a model of revival? A model of revival is that which is expressed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where everybody's moving in the gifts of the Spirit. What makes you any different from anybody else who just refuses to even believe that that exists as a possibility of an expression today? I mean, you would actually be better off as a cessationist who believes that it isn't even available today rather than believe in it and not do it and not participate in it and then be able to give yourself excuses like all of the problems are somehow either on somebody else or who knows. Rather than just recognizing, wait a minute, the Lord's just talking to me. He's just telling me I got to change. He's just telling me there's things got to be adjusted in my life. That there's things that are not matching up with Jesus. There's things that are not matching up with cooperation with the Holy Ghost. He's just trying to show me how the cares and the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasures of this life and the praises of men, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, have gripped my spirit and keeps me from moving with God. Because there's always the beautiful opportunity of repentance, and God works a miracle through repentance. It's the greatest act of change. Well, you know, when you talk about repentance, understand this. God granted to us the gift of repentance. Repentance really is more revealed and understood in the context of being born again, to be changed, to be made a new creation. The rest should really just be, you know, at forgiveness. But reality of it is there so much continual backsliding of coming, say, God, we're going to do it your way. We're going to walk in the Holy Ghost. We're going to be led by the Word. We're going to be conformed to your image. Lord, we're going to give ourselves to these things to be taught of the Holy Ghost. And then we just go back to our lifestyle. We go back to our former conversation. And you say, well, it's not wicked. No, it's not wicked, but it's absolutely choking the Word of God. It may not be by definition wickedness on the scale of homosexuality, murder, fornication, adultery, but all it is something that is keeping you from ever bringing forth fruit. And reality of it is, listen, I don't care if you're an adulteress or you don't bring forth fruit, the consequence is the same. You're going to wither, cast from the vine, gather them in, and be destroyed. So, people think, well, I'm just good, and I do everything right, and I try to be everything that God is pleased with. And you hear that from the Good Sam Club, and then the Good Slam Club too. The Good Sam Club. Oh, I just try to treat everybody good. I try to do what's right. I figure that, you know, I'm not any worse than anybody else. And you get a various different kinds of renditions of that in the Christian community. And that, what is that? Because I'm going to tell you right now, as far as those kinds of factors go, there's nobody in the Christian community that's going to keep up with the Orthodox Jews. Man, they looking good. From the perspective of outward holiness and the way they behave and the way that they conduct themselves in integrity and they keep themselves in every kind of purity. They wouldn't allow a TV in their house. They wouldn't allow, you know, a box of cereal in their house that had any display of anything that would be somehow, a reproach or immoral. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. And I could say the same thing of many other people, Mormons. I could go on. Why are those things proofs when God didn't make them proofs? Yeah, the fruits of the Spirit are proofs, but that's another realm, because now you're walking in love where there is no criticism. When you get love, now you're talking about, I'm going to lay down my life for you. There ain't nothing you can do. I'm not going to ever have a bad attitude. I'm going to love you. I'll serve you. I'll throw my body down on the ground so you can walk over me and not get your feet wet, kind of thing. No, really, having that kind of a servitude heart. Look at God's love. That's what he did for us, so to speak. He's the one, he didn't walk around with an attitude. You look at how many Christians walk around with an attitude. They're holding on to something, some offense, some unforgiveness, some kind of a sense of, well, he doesn't like me, she doesn't like me, some kind of strife, some kind of division, some kind of emulation. And there's no way that God, the Holy Ghost, is going to get near that. Hello! Why is this so hard for people to believe when the Bible is just all about the subject from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21? I don't get it. I don't get it. It is so apparent to me. Why is it that people that have intelligence, and it doesn't take much to get this, it doesn't take much intelligence to recognize the difference with somebody walking in the pride of life and somebody walking in humility and brokenness, being that it is defined as, on one hand, what men normally do, and on the other hand, what Jesus showed us when he laid his life down for us at Calvary, when he suffered at the whipping post, when he took a towel and a basin and washed our feet, when he humbled himself, made himself of no reputation, to become a servant for our own sakes, for our well-being, for our life, for our eternal status. We don't want to do it. We don't want to do it. And Father wants to change that about our hearts and our lives. He changed our heart when we were born again, but we allowed it to backslide. We allowed it to be altered. We agreed with lies. Lies will bring you into bondage. We agreed with lies. We agreed with falsehoods. We maybe even agreed with thoughts that we concluded in our own mind and derived from our own experiences in life. We went back to our former conversation and picked up a bunch of stuff that we learned in some class or from some unholy model or from some counsel of the ungodly. And we utilized that inside of the Word of God, mixed it together, had ourselves a wrong response. And it's time to repent. It's time to come back. It's time to have revival. A revival church is the expression and the flow of God the Holy Ghost. I mean, I'll tell you, from the time we walked in here tonight, there's been a flow of the Holy Ghost. I praise God for the songs of the Spirit. I praise God for that. But I want you to flow in the Holy Ghost more than just flowing with us. Because what's going to happen if we put you in your own meeting somewhere, that's what you have. And that's what the meeting is going to be. And then you have to ask yourself, if I had a meeting in my house or in someplace else, around the city or maybe around the world, how would that meeting be different from anybody else, any other normal religious everyday program? Where is the ministry of Jesus, in other words? Where is the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power? And you've got to have that. It needs to be developed in your life. And you either have it or you don't have it. And it really just comes down to how you're willing to be led, how you're willing to respond to God, how you're willing to surrender your things that you hold on to in your life over to Him and quit living your life for yourself and say and give yourself with all diligence to saying, I'm going to imitate Jesus Christ. I'm going to imitate God. Jesus said, if you want to be my disciples, you must imitate me. We translate it, you must follow me. It's the same word, you must mimic me, imitate me. Then Paul emphasizes in Ephesians 5:1, imitate God as dear children. That becomes a conscious consecration and commitment that it doesn't take long. I mean, I've found over and again that the first no is the hardest. The first saying no to whatever you're addicted to, whether it's yourself or alcohol or something else. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
The first no is the hardest. No, I'm not going to act that way. No, I'm not going to have that kind of response. No, I'm not going to have that behavior. No, I'm not going to have that opinion. I'm going to tell you right now, until you get yourself bathed in the Word, and really, and it's more than even bathed in the Word. It's for some people, it becomes a stronghold in your life where even if you're reading the Word of God, once again, it goes through the filter of your own self-interest and you're not hearing what God says. That's where fasting and prayer begins to beckon reality upon your soul. Begin to humble yourself before the presence of the Lord. Say, Father, obviously I don't get this. Obviously I'm reading this wrong. And I want to understand exactly what you're saying because I keep riding myself into the expression of I've got it, I'm good, I can see, I'm, the Laodicean, right? I'm clothed, I'm rich. And the Lord's saying, no, you're not. You're wretched, miserable, naked, and blind. And, What really helps is when you stand before the Lord and say, Lord, am I wretched, miserable, naked, and blind? I've done that. And I make sure that I stay there in that posture. I don't walk around saying, oh, I'm good. Oh, yeah, we're doing great. Oh, wow, we're the model of it. It what? What's it? Rather, you stand before the Lord, Father, I want to be corrected. I want to understand. Lord, I recognize my need to come into a place of greater brokenness and greater humility and greater servitude and greater submission. Where I speak by the Spirit of the Lord and quit serving my own interest and speaking, all the things that I think and I believe and I know. Because faith isn't going to work there to start with, and whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And I'm telling you right, faith isn't going to work there to start with once again. And where there is no faith, Jesus is not going to be revealed. And where faith isn't operating, the Holy Ghost is not doing anything. And all you're going to do is be stuck in whatever skill set was thrown to you by the cast of the die, so to speak, in your genetics. That's it. You've got purely human. And inside of 48 hours, it smells real bad without a shower. Are you with me?
Yes.
And give it a week, and it looks really torn down. 1 week, no shower, no bathing. You're with me. Greasy-headed, come on. Dirt on your face. Are you listening to me? Smelling like, whew, who just walked in? And that's what we're so high on? That's what we're so thrilled with? Wait a minute. Why would we be? Why logically would we be so impressed with something so corruptible? Something so frail? Something really, when it comes to the reality of what man is, fallen man is, a completely repulsive in every way to God. Repulsive to God. God commended his love towards us when we were repulsive, when we were alienated by wicked works. Understand what God says about wicked works. He calls it an abomination. It is another word for extremely repulsive. I mean, it's worse than repulsive. Do you understand what I'm saying? I think that we ought to somehow deal with the reality that Father is not impressed with anything that is human. Father is not impressed with anything that looks and behaves after the manner of Adam, or after the manner, even worse, of that which possessed Adam, which every human being was fashioned and formed in until they were redeemed, and that is the demon spirits that occupy the world that so many people are willing to be influenced by. Why they say they're not. Why they all talk about how they're an individual and a free thinker, and a free spirit, and all whatever else that goes on. Huh? I'm not a free spirit. I'm a slave to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm harabokos tateya. My freedom is being submitted to God the Holy Ghost and being under his rulership. Hallelujah. His sovereign rulership, which is witnessed by the reality that I love learning. I want to be the first one to sign up to come to brokenness and lowliness classes. And every time you come to the meeting, you're coming to a brokenness and lowliness practice while you act like this is your house and that you're in charge. You need to go back to your kitchen to be in charge of your life. Well, wherever it is, your domain, wherever that is. Because here you're supposed to come in on your knees, bowing low. Not with all your opinions and all your ideas and all your, you know, feeling good about yourself because somebody praised you today or somebody gave you a promotion, or feeling bad about yourself because somebody cursed you today or you got a demotion. All that realm. Feeling good about yourself because everything went your way, or feeling terrible because and questioning God because your circumstances was opposed to you from the moment you woke up this morning till you got here. And it's still opposed to you because of what I'm saying. Are you listening to me? Yes. Listen to me, because it shows that your interests are integrated into the will and the mind of the world. When these things don't have any impact on you, then you know, they don't have an offense towards you. They don't change your disposition. Hallelujah. You're still just as full of joy, unspeakable and full of glory, still rejoicing in God, your Savior, still moving in the same confidence, same boldness. You can begin to recognize, wait a minute, I'm not integrated with the world anymore. I don't draw my identity, what my value system, my comfort, my joy in any way from the world. God has given me a joy and a peace that the world cannot give me. The world can give you a joy and peace, and boy, do we ever know that. We probably know that better than we know about the joy, in many cases, the joy and the peace that God gives us by the Holy Spirit, because we're constantly being swayed one way or the other based upon what is happening in a natural, everyday occurrence. And when that's not important to you anymore, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to see him before you and at your right hand that you should not be moved. Suddenly, God's going to be able to start doing the things he's wanted to do in your life and be there showing himself to be on your side, working on your behalf. Soon as you are no longer blinded by self-interest, integrated with the world system, moved by its cares and interests. You listening to me? Because I'm talking to you by the Holy Ghost, and I'm not talking to anybody on the web right now. They're going to benefit, or you do. I'm talking to you and you and you and you. I'm talking to every one of you sitting in this place. God, the Holy Spirit, is saying, when do I get a chance with your life? When will you quit playing make-believe and pretend? When will you stop saying you got something that you have no evidence for, and start humbling yourself, getting truthful with God? He's a spirit of truth. And when you say, Lord, I want these things in my life. When all of a sudden you wake up in the night and, you know, you're just, you know, going to the restroom or getting a drink of water or whatever, you're just awake in the night, it's just so on you. Father, I want to learn your humility. There's nothing so more, so beautiful. Instead of, oh God, I want to win the grand prize. Oh God, when are you going to make me wealthy? Oh God, when am I going to get this? When am I going to get some recognition? Or whatever goes on in people's hearts and minds, because that stuff goes on in people's minds and hearts. It's very few people who've all of a sudden recognized that the treasure isn't lowliness and meekness. The treasure is learning how to walk humbly with your God so that you can do righteousness and so that you can love mercy, because you're never going to do righteousness and you're never going to love mercy until you start walking humbly. Until you start walking in submission and brokenness, and you're never going to be, you never can say that you are walking in humility and brokenness and submission to God when you're not walking in humility and brokenness and submission to those that are around you. You can't say that you love God when you don't love the people that are around you. And we're not just talking about any kind of love. We're not, people want to substitute this kind of, you know, likey love, human love, for what God is saying. And he said, here's how we discern love. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 16, here's how we discern love. 1 John 3:16, here's how we discern love. You want to be able to discern love? You understand what we're talking about, what God's talking about when we talk about love? Herein is how we discern love. For Christ's love for, us. He died for us. He gave himself a sacrifice for us. Here, he laid down his life for us. He went to a whipping post for us. And then back up before that, he who became poor for our sake. He took all his wealth to purchase you and me. He put it all in an offering basket for you. Huh? And you're digging around in your wallet wondering what you can let go of. People, God ain't going to be able to do supernatural blessings in your finances so long as that goes on. You've got to somehow be able to hear the word of God. It mixed with faith. You're going to take the risk. Feed the prophet first. And then watch what happens. Now, while everybody else is starving, your flour and your oil does not diminish. Huh? Long as she lived, I'm sure it went beyond the famine. I'm sure of it. That never diminished. And I could go on and on and on and on and on with those examples of what God demands and what he calls faith. We want to make faith all these other things that accommodate what we're doing so we feel good about ourselves, because that's where we're stuck. Self. Are you listening to me? Yes. The reality of it is when we get real honest with God in the spirit of truth, and he knows it. God, the Holy Ghost, is the expert of truth. He knows when we get honest. All of a sudden, we get honest, and he turns and goes, what? You're praying now? You know? This is amazing. What is it that you're saying there? You want help because you're not doing it right? Yeah, I'm going to give you help. You want to get it right? You want to learn lowliness? You want to learn how to walk in love? You want to learn how to be kept by my power? I'm here to help you. Keep talking, because I'm going to hook up with that and explode some divine power on the inside of you so you find the strength and ability to do it. I mean, I think one of the great prayers that we pray for ourselves is, Lord, strengthen me by your spirit in my inner being. So that I do it exactly like you described it, that I see it exactly like you said it, that I hear it just like you meant it, because we're always spinning the stuff. If you don't believe that people are spinning stuff, get 10 people, sit them down and tell them something, and then the day later, ask them what you told them. And go ahead and let them make notes too. Believe me, dear people. I've had some really interesting statements given to me. Oh, I remember when you said, I did? I said that? Yes, I remember it. Well, first of all, I got to try to get past your photographic memory for a moment. You know, second of all, there's no way I ever said that. But, you know, it's just in crazy stuff. I'm not going to go into it, because it's just, some of his stuff is just so far-fetched. Lord Jesus. Some of it we have just keep it documented just to look at every once in a while going, Lord, help me to remember that we're going to have a Holy Ghost breakthrough for people to be even able to hear one thing that you have to say about us. Because we're going to spin it into what is going to serve ourselves and our self-interest, what we think it needs to be said. And if we don't like what's being said, boy, do we ever got a shield? Huh? Do we ever have a shield that goes up? And it's an offense shield. Not an offensive shield, an offense shield. You're not talking to me. I'm looking at you, but you're not talking. I can tell when I'm talking to people and their response to me is, I know you're talking to me, but I'm not listening. I'm not listening anymore. And it wouldn't be so bad if it was just a response to human beings. It wouldn't be so bad, but it's a response to God. Humility creates great honor. It does. And before you're going to ever have honor, you're going to have humility. Humility creates great honor. Humility creates within our life an honor for everyone. Okay? There's not a person in this place that I don't love and I don't honor. I have to deal with the revelation of the word of knowledge and discerning of spirits of stuff that is going on in your life that I don't like, and that it's really frustrating because you won't listen and change because you're just stuck in yourself. And you're right. And if you understand it and you can relate to it and it's real to you and meaningful to you, then fine. Otherwise, you're just going to have to stop that, because that's not a servant. And that's not submission. And that's not being under the authority of God's word and God's Holy Spirit. And ultimately, that's how you read the Bible. I want to help you, people. We want to help you. We want to help you. We want to help you move into a flow of the Holy Ghost that is so refreshing that when you get to the meeting, by the time we get, by the time you get finished with praise and worship, we might as well go home. Huh? Because look, if everybody in this place simply would begin, as I wanted to just model just a little bit on Sunday night, begin to flow in the Holy Ghost and begin to just have that one explosive expression, even for 30 seconds. I have a hard time only having a 30-second explosion of the Holy Ghost. But that's a starting point. That's more than you've had in a long time in the meeting. Okay? 30 seconds? Whew, that's a step up. When's the last time you had a 5-second explosion of the Holy Ghost? Think about it. And if everybody did that for 1 minute in the place, and there's 100 people in the house, goodness gracious, we're done. We've been exhorted. We've heard words from heaven. Out of that, faith came. It continued to build upon itself. Everybody got healed. Every heart was revealed. Those who were lost said, God is in this place. So how long we got to talk to you about these things? Another 20 years? Another 30 years? Another 40 years? How long are you going to read your own writing and read your own experience into these things and not be willing to move on with God? Because he doesn't ever turn anybody away who comes to him hungry. Amen. You just got to get hungry. He never turns anybody away who comes thirsty. Everybody who's thirsty gets to drink. So the issue comes right down always to you and I, not the Father. He's here to He's here to to explode. And then there's emotional explosion. That is really something where God is moving through the midst of our spirit, moving through the midst of our passion, our emotion, moving through the dimensions of our heart and our thinking and our thoughts. Wow. Woo! God thoughts. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. When you begin to speak out of this realm of the heart by the Holy Ghost, out of this place of truth, out of this place of reality, out of this place that God only God can produce within our life because we're submitted to him. My, it is the greatest thing. It is the most refreshing. Sickness goes, problems goes, issues go. Faith rises, it grows, it matures. When all of a sudden out of your passions, out of your emotions, out of the depths of every one of your affections, out of the innermost being we call the belly, begins to flow this divine glory. I'm going to tell you, it's explosive. I had about 3 people on the front row Sunday night. Huh? And then some of you were borderlining on it. You know, over here with Annalyn, then Joshua, then Ruthie, and I was just waiting on God. I want you to go there. I want you to cover it to go there. You got to cover it to prophesy. You're going to have to get liberated, become childlike, and say, I want this. I'm going to do this. I want this more than anything else. I want this more than money. I want this more than the praises of men. I want this more than my own security. I want this more than my daily bread. I want this more than all the other things. Oh, God, there's no one I have in heaven but you, and you are all that I desire in the earth. No, I have no one in heaven but you, and you fulfill and fill up all my desires in the earth.
Amen.
That's true for me. It's not true. It's not just for the psalmist. It's not just what the psalmist said. It's true for me. God wants to be true for you. Whew, hallelujah. What is that? Psalm 72 or 73? I have no one in heaven but you. It is an amazing thing when God becomes the definition of our life. When God becomes the definition of our being, that we would even have the right to even say that, to even have the right to believe that, much less to have the empowerment to live that. And somehow, it's not what's first on our minds when we wake up. It's not what we seek after. And that's got to change. Reality's got to come. A brokenness has got to come. A confrontation with the things that have held you back has got to take place. That's up to you, not me, not God. You. It's up to you. You want to point the fingers, well, it's because of this. No. That's nonsense. That's pride of life. That's rebellion speaking. That's defiance speaking. That's self-preservation speaking. Father says, look, with a big smile, with open arms, with a love in his heart, you may have all my life. I want you to have it, but you got to lose yours because I'm not going to integrate with you. That's the confrontation. If you lose your life, you can have his life. If you hold on to your life, you're going to lose it. You're going to lose it. And I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're a preacher. I don't care if you're a person who's, you were born in church. You were born, literally, your mom had you on the back row and you came out. And right afterwards, you were speaking in tongues before you even had the English language. Before you had a normal, earthly language, if it's even possible, kind of is with John the Baptist. You had a spirit expression before there was an earthly expression. Unless you're willing to lose your own life, you're not going to have his. People come up with all of these reasons why and all these proofs and all these evidence and all these certainties, and not one of them's in the book. Not one of them. And here we are laboring to show you the proofs, laboring to show you the will of God, that all you're going to do is bow your knee and say, Lord, to do your will, whatever it takes. Hear my, oh God. I'm going to learn how to deny myself. I'm going to learn how to cast down imaginations. I'm going to learn how to cast down thoughts. I'm going to learn how to cast down responses and behaviors that are purely human, designed by demon spirits. And I'm going to learn how to give myself rather to the Holy Ghost. I'm going to learn how to think like you think, God. And people, I'm going to tell you right now, when you open up the door to other things, I mean, there's a lot of different things. When you open up the door to these various different realms of sin and iniquity, it just floods you with that much more blindness. Only purity can see. Understand this. Only purity. The pure in heart see God. Only purity. That's why I love purity. Purity allows you 20/20 vision in the spirit. It allows you to see into the unseen realm. You're not any more conflicted and bogged down with those things that the realms of the demonic impose upon us and cause spiritual blindness. Come on in. Spirit of the Lord is calling you, so just come on in. If you think you can come in by you and that you're going to somehow be, God's going to be like, wow, man, I'm so glad you're here. Maybe you can help me with the problem I'm having. Then you're fully mistaken of the whole events that have gone down for the past 6,000 years. Father's made a way where you and I come in by the very life of Jesus. His blood represents life. His very life, by his spirit. His very life, where we're no longer in existence. We're in him, praise God. And he's in us, this oneness and unit. He's not coming. You can't come to God with all of your stuff. You stay outside. You're not coming in with all of your stuff. It's going to be cleansed. It's going to be washed away. You're going to come in with thanksgiving and praise, being completely burden-freed. Hallelujah. You're going to cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you and come on in. You're going to come in and draw near to him with a true heart in full assurance of the faith. Listen, you get to come near with a true heart in full assurance of the faith. All these other expressions that say you're going to come to God with all these other things and in all these other ways are lies. There's only one way into his presence. It's the life of Jesus. There's only one way to draw near unto him. It's with all boldness. Huh? There's only one way to be acceptable by unto him. Hallelujah. There's only one way to be able to interact with him. Come on. There's not a person in this place who has an excuse to be anything less than full of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
As many people as we brought through to this place, come on. I'm Brink on the 16th of October. I'm Richard, come back. Tim's coming on the 30th. Tim Hall's coming on 30th of October. I believe they've had 60,000 people saved over the past 8 months. He just had an incredible meeting in Japan. What is it? Vanuatu. I was going to say Vanuatu. It's Vanuatu. Vanuatu. I mean, it's on and on. Just wow, man. And Tim is just worn out. Once again, the few doing the work of the many. Because people just sitting around in great Holy Ghost churches where the Spirit of the Lord is fully revealed, supplying all the insight and revelation needed, but it's not being mixed with faith. And it's the same thing that happened to Israel. The gospel was preached to them, but it never profited them. They never really went beyond just the casual encounter. Look, there's the glory cloud. Hallelujah. There's the cloud by day. Praise God for some shade. Oh, we got manna again. Well, that's better to have manna than nothing. Thank you, Jesus, kind of thing. This is the people of God. Everybody got baptized at the same time. What a meeting. What a baptismal meeting. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you even understand that we're talking about you?
Yes.
Can you even understand that?
Yes.
That when you read that God is talking about the possibility of you running the same kind of ruin.
Yes.
If you don't allow what he said to become a living reality where you say, forget about all that stuff. I'm following you, and it's something that's done with the heart and the passion, and people want to make it about their circumstance and their environment. God's interested in your heart, not your clothes. Your heart will take care of your clothes. Hallelujah. God's interested with the inward man. The inward man will take care of all the places and all of that you're going and all the things that you're doing. Oh, brabasidetapat. And God is interested in that inner man and that heart maturing and growing. And the things that only happen through fellowship. Stunted spiritual growth is a serious disease. It's a spiritual disease. Listen, the gospel has to be preached by the manifestation of the life of Jesus. It's not just word. It's the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power. People just want to make it about what they can do, what they can control, what they can conceive, what they can believe, their ideas, their concepts. If your ideas and your concept isn't working out a revelation of Jesus, I'm not interested in your ideas and concepts, and I don't want them. I really don't want them. I don't want to hear. It's like a scientist friend of mine said, don't say anything. Don't contaminate my pure thoughts. Let me work out the thing first. Then you can give your information. I thought, that's pretty good. That is pretty good right there, eh? Huh? Listen, dear people, reality of it is, are we going to hearken to the Word? Are we going to run with the Word of God? Are we going to do the things of the Spirit? Are we going to hold on to our own life? All of us got a choice of holding on to our own life. I had a choice to hold on to my own life. I still have the choice. I make the choice every day. Am I going to do it my way? Am I going to hold on to my life? Am I going to do that which is going to preserve my own interest? That's what's going to, you know, reduce the risk and secure my position? Or with total abandonment? Huh? Am I going to live as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God? Hallelujah. I love being in this place. Hallelujah. Then Debbie's going to come the week after. I'm going to just have boom, boom, boom. And I've really been praying about, thinking about doing some extended meetings in there. And just waiting on the Lord. People, God's interested in you.
Yes.
God, the Holy Spirit has great plans for you. He's looking for somebody who he can show forth his power through in this place called San Diego, this region. He's looking for somebody who's willing to just, with total abandonment, go do what it is he said to do and live out his life and learn it and be taught by the Holy Ghost doing it his way. Because otherwise it becomes just a flash in the pan. It was faith and excitement, but it was zeal more than it was knowledge, and all of a sudden it blew up. But when you go in and say, okay, Holy Spirit, teach me your loneliness. Teach me your meekness. Teach me how to walk in that love. Teach me how to be kept in that peace that the world can't in any way interfere with. Teach me, oh God, how to be separated unto you, how to be enclosed and engulfed with that glorious realm of Holy Ghost fire where now circumstances and situations have no effect on me. It's a measure. It's a thermometer. How much do circumstances and situations around your life impact you emotionally? It's a thermometer. It is a thermometer, and the more it impacts you, the more you are ruled by self and the world. Self and the world. Listen to me. That starts shutting. You start getting that thing down. I'm going to tell you right now, all these things that in the realms of problems, temptations, wrong attitudes, wrong activities of the spirit, they begin to shut down. It just begins to shut down. You're not entangled anymore with the affairs of this life. You want to please God? What does God say to do? Don't be entangled with the affairs of this life. Does he say it or not? That's what he says and addresses to Timothy. You want to please God? Then don't walk after your own human ability in an earthly human realm. You want to please God? Then begin to walk in faith and quit making faith up to be some kind of philosophical ideology. It is risky. Faith is the regions that you cannot yourself control. Faith is going beyond your own human effort and human ability. Faith is stepping out of the natural into the supernatural and believing God for the miracle to happen. Faith is laying down your life so that God can be revealed. That's faith. Hallelujah. Come on now, it's time to start moving in faith. We have access by faith. You want faith. I guarantee you want faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Faith isn't just coming to church. Faith, in fact, is coming to church expecting that which God described the church to be, to exist in you. How can you and I tolerate or abide any expression less than faith? How is it that we then somehow are so influenced by a religion that it makes us accommodate something that is so contrary to God's will? To come to church and sit there, and all you do is express yourself in song, and that not with great passion. Now, I'm not just talking to people here. I'm talking to people on the web, too. But some of you, there's many of you, I could take some of you right now and say, I've never really seen a display of Holy Ghost passion through your life. Maybe once or twice since I've known you. And some of you I've known in a long time. And I've told you, and I've warned you, and I've called you out, but you will not listen, and you would not respond. And it's not me calling you out and speaking to you, it's God the Holy Ghost. So then, by definition, you have hardened your heart against the Spirit of the Lord. Where every time you refuse, every time you disobey, the heart gets hardened. I'd rather have hardened arteries. I would rather have a heart condition after the physical rather than having a heart condition after the spiritual. Both can be healed by God. But I'm going to tell you, as it matures and as it becomes more fortified in your life by continual disobedience and defiance and rebellion and hardness against God, the harder the miracle to take place, and you may die in your sin. Don't you tell me hardness against God isn't sin. Don't you tell me that an unwillingness to hear the word of God and fall down on your knees and repent and say, I'm sorry, teach me, Lord, is somehow acceptable to God, because it's not. And I want you to hear it, says the Lord. I'm here a prophet to you tonight. I'm here a minister of the gospel to you tonight. I'm here a pastor to you tonight. True.
Amen.
True.
Amen.
But you think about it. Maybe there's actually some people in this place that you've never recognized me as either. Potentially. Potentially. And it's, I'm not just talking about some verbal expression of pastor or servant of the Lord or man of God. Because I, you know what? There's a saying that says familiarity breeds contempt. But that's among the realms of human beings trapped in the worldly realm. Should not be among God's people who are of the Spirit, who know no man after the flesh. Though we knew Christ after the flesh, now we know him no more. For if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are new, and all things are of God. So that now what Paul is driving home is that the expression of our life is knowing who we are after what God has assigned us to be. Amen. And what God has ordained us to be. Huh? You know, sometimes I hear people talk about some minister who, you know, who's anointed by God and fell, or some anointed minister of God who's maybe not doing things right, tracking things right. And I'm thinking, you know, it's amazing to me that people who've done the least got the biggest and loudest expression of what's wrong with the anointing. And that is nothing more than a display of demon power. That's all it is. And if you think that's not a display of demon power, it's simply because you don't understand. You don't have a discernment. Get a hold of the Spirit of the Lord and the Word of God. Hallelujah. Start walking with God and you'll get it. And I'm here devoted to you getting it.
Yes.
I'm here devoted to keeping you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, I'm happy to stay in that realm of just worship because it's beautiful. But I have a hard time looking out and seeing people off in humanity doing their own thing in my papa's house. His zeal eats me up. You know what I'm saying? And just imagine papa gets his belt out after you, and you the one he's chasing out the house. Think about it. I don't ever want that to be me. I've said to the Lord, Lord, am I the merchandiser? Lord, am I the one who is carrying vessels through your house? Am I the one who's somehow making your house something less than that which is your house of prayer, that place that you set your name, where you would be revealed in the midst of your people? Have I made your house anything less than the sacred realm that it is? If I have, oh God, search me now, forgive me now, change me now. And then I know then that there will an event take place because I feel what's going on inside of me when I walk into the place. I bow under the anointing. I feel that manifest presence. The fear of the Lord is on me. The awe of God possesses me. I'm not off in some what somebody did, what happened over here, and what happened over there, what I think and what I like. I'm over in a place where the Spirit of the Lord rules me and the Word of God rests on me and the fear of God overwhelms me. Come on, people. Let's get real with God. Come on, people. Let's get beyond whatever it is we've been living in and start living in the reality of a living Christ Jesus and a Holy Ghost that is present here with us and in us. And if he's not real enough for you to feel, you need to get yourself right with God. If he's not real enough for you to feel, you need to get yourself right with God. If he's not real enough to you to overwhelm and explode on the inside of you and cause a drop to your knees, brokenness, you need to get right with God.
Amen.
This is the truth. Whether or not you will hearken to the word of the Lord, rest in your court of your own interest and your own will. But as for me, in my house, you're not going to find a bunch of religious people. You're going to find people who have the Holy Ghost and a response to God, a passion and respect and reverence and divine interaction. Come on now. Well, it's not interested in how much scripture you know. He's not interested. He didn't keep record on how many times you were in church. It's your heart. It's your passion. It's truth. It's hunger. It's thirst. is obedience. It's the response. Huh? Yes. You know the whole Bible and not obey half of it. You know the whole Bible, many people know the whole Bible and don't obey a fraction of it. Come on now. Yeah. It's time to obey. Yes. Spirit of obedience is here with us. His name is the Holy Ghost. Yes. Spirit of obedience lives in us. Perfect obedience, Christ Jesus. Perfect obedience, Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 10, the Lord says to us, "For he that has entered into the rest, he is also the one who has ceased from his own works as God did from his." And I want to emphasize this to you in the ministry and the life of Jesus, because works that God has called us to do is his works. God has called us to cease from our own works and enter into his works. And the one who modeled that for us is Jesus. He showed us exactly what that means. He defined it perfectly. And it's up to you and I now as to whether or not we're going to respond to God. And so let's just quickly go over and look, for example, now in John chapter 10, verse 38. And I want you to understand that the rest is there connected with us doing the works of God, because there's one of two options. Our own works, which we are to have ceased from, or God's works. You're never moving into God's works until you cease from your own works. If you're not doing God's works, it's because you are in your own works. There is no two places to live. Quit self-serving your reading of the Word of God and start bowing the knee to get it right. You listen to me. Because this is what it comes down. God demands truth. He's not going to play your little human games. The ones that you learned in grammar school, in elementary school, rather, and in middle school, and the rest of your schools, and all the other interactions in life. It means nothing to God. The wisdom of man is foolishness to God. It's foolishness. Whatever you're so confident in is foolishness to God. He's brought to us his eternal spirit. He's brought to us the realms of his divine love and glory. My goodness, if we turn up our nose to what God has given and go and pursue our own interests, that could not be a greater expression of disrespect and defiance. Could not be. Jesus said, and go look with me here in John chapter 10, verse 38. Hallelujah. I'm building this model, and I just built it slow, just example of what you could do if you spend 10 minutes a day doing something. And I'm, after so long a time now, all things are coming together. And I was looking through every angle, looking through the door coming from the south gate, looking through the door coming through the east gate, looking through the door coming through the west gate. And anytime you look through, all you can see is the altar. That's all you can see. The altar. There's no way that you and I ever get to come to that place of interaction with God until the altar becomes the full view of every one of our perceptions, to where that we begin to delight to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. People, you can't have a defiled altar and expect to be right with God, because all you're going to have is departed glory. It's true. You need to think about the things that defile the altar. And recognize, it's just, Papa's made it just too easy. He's made it too easy. But the easiness of it all is the response of total abandonment. Because if it's not total abandonment, then it's very difficult. It's confusing. If it's not a complete surrender of your life, it's all convoluted. If there's holding on to any of the self and a place for self to reign and dominate, then all of a sudden deception sets in. Jesus said in John chapter 10 and verse 38, he says, But if I do, though you believe me not, believe the works that ye may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. So let me get verse 37. If I do not the works of my Father, don't believe me. That needs to be us. That became the cry of every man of God who stepped into a display of the life and ministry of Jesus the way God designed it. It wasn't something that they said after they became well known. You know that was already going on in their mouth and their expressions long before anybody saw them but Jesus. Long before they ever stood before anyone other than the Holy Ghost. Long before there was ever a platform, they were standing before the Father getting real with God, saying before him, Lord, if it's not your works, then I'm not going to believe it. Lord, if your works are not expressed in me, I'm going to get right until they are, because I recognize that I am wrong. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying right here in verse 37. If the works of God are not in me, then it is because I am wrong. He's talking about the works of God. Those works were seen in turning the water into wine. It was the display of heaven. It was the display of the result of being baptized in the Holy Ghost. As soon as the Holy Ghost came upon him, as soon as he was baptized in the Holy Ghost, he came in the Spirit and in the power of the Lord. He turned the water into wine. Devils had to obey him. His passion for the lost was that which got him, kept him up all night. And on and on and on, all of the works displayed. The opening of the eyes of the blind, the setting liberty, setting those who are captive free, setting at liberty those who were bound. Hallelujah. Preaching the gospel to the poor, shining with the servitude and the brokenness of God, meek and lowly. Hallelujah. Mazapataropakaya. Manda, raising the boy to life again at Nain. The works of God. He that has entered into the rest has ceased from his own works. The Lord says, come on into my rest. All you that are weary, heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I've got a rest for you to come into. Here it is. It's coming to this place of submitting to the nature of God, the will of God, the way of God, the interest of God, the meekness and the lowliness of God. You're going to have to quit fastening yourself after the conversation of the wicked, after the ways of the world. You're going to have to stop being conformed to the world. Because that's what's going on. Heaven is going to produce the works of God. So Jesus said, if I do not the works of my Father, do not believe me. He said, but if I do the works of my Father, though you don't believe me, believe the works that ye may know, and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. I am in him. And the Lord then takes at that and enjoins that unto us in this oneness over and over again. I can take you right now and show you 12 highlights of the Lord saying the same thing, that this is what he's given to us, that Father is in Christ Jesus, that Father dwells in us, that Christ Jesus dwells in us, and we dwell in him. And the results of our life ought to be the same results that he expressed in his life. That is the only means by which we know we're following Jesus. It is the only proof that we are submitted to his word and to his Spirit.
Yes. Amen.
And when you all of a sudden recognize that this is the truth, you're going to quit patting yourself on the back for your mediocrity and disobedience. Huh? And accommodating what's been going on in your life that is repulsive to God and insult to his witness. This is true. So I'm inviting you into my world. I'm inviting you into the world of the Holy Ghost. I'm inviting you into the world of the kingdom of God. I'm inviting you into what it means to take up your cross and deny yourself and start living your life out for what God designed and fashioned it to be when he recreated you anew and fashioned you after his own image and likeness in his own righteousness and holiness and gave to you the divine nature when he breathed into you the Spirit of God. The breath that you have is not your own. God gave it to you. You're sitting there breathing out the grace of God. Being stingy with your life. Stop it now.
Amen.
Stop it now. Stop it now. Not only did he create you and give you that breath of life and give you the being that you have and the existence you have, he then went to the extent that he did to redeem it, to purchase it for himself. And then we are going to deny that he purchased us by living for ourselves. Deny that he purchased us by living for our own will, doing it our own way, making our own rules, deciding for ourselves what we believe is right and what we believe is wrong. God's given us the opportunity to be endued with the Holy Ghost, to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, to have the mind of the Spirit, to have the mind of Christ, to walk in the glory of God, to live out the very expression of our lives. The very expressions of our life is one of the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit. We either give Him forth prophecy or revelation, or we're speaking by the word of knowledge or by the word of wisdom, or we're doing miracles or working gifts of healing or moving and functioning in faith, or we're tongues or interpretation of tongues or having dreams or visions. This Rabbi Yitzhak recently died, 108 years old. And it's ridiculous how many national catastrophes he had a vision and a dream of before they happened, while the church is sitting over here blind. Before he died, Jesus came to him. It turned the Haredim, the Orthodox Jews, upside down. Because he told them that the Messiah came to him, and that he was not going to reveal the Messiah's name until after he was dead. And he died 2 months later, And he said, but you cannot open up the letter and read it until a year after I'm dead. And they opened up the letter, and it was he revealed the name of the Messiah who came and appeared to him, Yehoshua. Hallelujah. Yeshua, or Jesus. And everybody said, there's something wrong here. And his son's 84 years old, another famous rabbi and most learned scholar. And he says, no, that's what he wrote. That's what he said. That's it. There's no confusion about it. Come on, man. While we're sitting over here walking around saying we're baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire and God, what? Come on, people. It's time to step up. It's time to quit playing patty cake games, make believe with God. Religious things, religious stuff. Walk or trample all over the sacred and the anointing and wonder why God don't move in our life. You get the zeal of the Lord.
Yes.
You get the zeal of the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. And you'll get sick of yourself. And you'll hate your own life in this world. And you'll love the fact that you get the life of God and you'll want to live it. And the idea that you're His tabernacle, His dwelling place, and that He's given you an unlimited access unto Him, a oneness with Him, the ability to function in His glory and fully represent Him will absolutely arrest your being, and you will pursue it with all that you, with all haste, with all speed, with all you have.
Amen.
That's the mark of revival.
Amen.
That's the mark of truth.
Amen.
Come on now. Don't blame me because I see it. Don't be offended me just because I see it. Just because I've moved in a little closer with heaven to see it, to know the reality of it, to be touched by the presence of God, to say, wait a minute, something really seriously wrong here. There's too much compromise. Come on, people. God's calling. Father wants to be revival. You know, it's amazing to me. God's people are just, they're so bent on their own, doing it their own way, believing it their own way. They're crying out for God to have, to do and move and make and have this great awakening when there's no revival in this house. When there's very, and it's very few places that you see the revival. And when I'm talking about revival, I'm talking about us stepping into what God has given to us, what He's made available to us, which is nothing less and nothing more than the ministry of Jesus, which is more than enough. It's the works of God. Hallelujah. And if we don't have them, then don't believe us, world. If you do not have the works of God, then don't believe us. And if you don't believe my words, and if you don't believe what I'm saying, believe me for my work's sake, because they prove it that God is in me. And it's the Father that does the work. It's the proof that Christ Jesus is in me and that He does the work. And when you and I stand before God and He sees that kind of passion and that kind of seriousness towards Him and that kind of truth in the inward parts, we will have the works.
Yes.
And there will be change. And there will be an ever-growing display of the river of God and the wellspring of God, the expressions of the Holy Ghost. And we won't just continually talk to people who just seemingly won't respond.
Yes.
Just like
Thank you, Lord.
Year after year after year. Enough.
Yes.
Enough. Let the fire of God fall.
Yes.
Let the fire of God fall.
Lord.
I'm going to tell you right now, I'm reaching into a realm in the spirit that when I call the fire of God down on somebody, that it's good and bad. that it results in change.
Yes.
And it's good and bad. But nonetheless, it results in change.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
I was in a place not too long ago, Ann and I, and I saw some people diddle down and around. They were messing around with God. They were pretending. They knew they were pretending, though. A lot of people mess around with God. They don't even know it. They don't know they're pretending. And they were on the musical instruments. I walked over to them. I said, I know exactly who you are and what you're doing. And they're looking at me like, I said, I'm calling the fire of God down on you right now. And I did. I mean, I was an authority. I called the fire of God down on them. I know exactly what it wasn't good. They ain't pretending, not pretending no more. I'm reaching in to an authority in the kingdom of God where people are not going to be able to continue on misrepresenting the kingdom of God, misrepresenting the Holy Ghost, misrepresenting this wonderful realm of the ministry of Jesus Christ. Because look, a lost and dying world is being held back from harvest with all this misrepresentation and false witness going on. It's about time for somebody to have, you know, to hear Father say, Son of man, what do you see? What do you think we ought to do? Let's call the fire down. Let's get this thing out of the way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was talking to Pat Schatzline today, and he was saying some things, and I started to type, you know, only the remnant can see it, because that it would be a true statement, especially in the context of when you look through the Bible of the backslidden state of Israel. Only the remnant could see what God was actually saying, the truth. Everybody else was caught up in deception, believing that they were so right. And as I was getting ready to type, only the remnant can see it, the Lord rebuked me. So I typed to him, because we were just typing back and forth. I said, Pat, I was getting ready to type, only the remnant could see it, and the Lord rebuked me, because he's going to cause all the world to see and behold it. He is. And you know what? Who he's going to do it through? You know who he's going to do it through? The remnant. The people who've not bowed their knee. Who've not turned aside to seek their own way. To do their own thing. Who have responded to his word and come separate themselves unto him. Who demand of themselves what God commands. There's too many people who want to play games. They want to just play games. It's just all over their face. You stop that right now in the name of Jesus. You start demanding of yourself what God commands. I'm going to tell you, one of the first things that's going to work, it's going to get rid of the high-mindedness. It's going to start creating humility in your life, because you're not going to, you know, your welfare isn't going to be promoted anymore. You're not going to live in the condemnation of feeling bad about yourself because you feel so good about yourself. Feeling bad about yourself because you so esteem yourself, so whatever it is you esteem yourself to be. Because suddenly you start recognizing what God wants you to be, and you start measuring yourself according to what Christ Jesus called you to be, we're going to start working some brokenness. Yes. You're either going to have to go into a deeper deception, or it's going to work brokenness. It's a pathway. It's a fork in the road. It's either deeper deception of self-justification and writing your own expressions into what God says, or it's a brokenness and, Father, I can't believe this. What's happened? It's what happened to John Hyde. It's what happened to Jonathan Goforth. It's what happened to all the revivalists. You look back. It's just what happened to them. They confronted one day. They had a confrontation. They had a revelation. Suddenly their eyes were open. They said, wait a minute. I'm not doing what the Bible says. I don't look like, this isn't the ministry of Jesus. My life doesn't express the ministry of Jesus. And it busted them in two. And they began to scream out like they were dying men. Like they were dying men who were in false religion, who were failing of the truth, crying out to God, oh God, I have not entered into your rest. And they changed the world. Truth will change the world. And truth has to begin with you and me. And truth is about our communion with the Word of truth, the Spirit of truth, Christ Jesus, the truth. I'm going to skip over a bunch of these verses of Scripture, just kind of jump right quickly to John chapter 14. This is what I want. Asita le mekisha pokura mane kapataya. Halabosita. Hallelujah. What was the words of those song? What was that word of the, what was the words of that song? Lord, I love being your dwelling place, hey? What was that? What were the words of that song? Huh? Mondakia. Huh? Could you put it up? I just sing by the Spirit. It's not in my memory. Sikando boshikanda yesha. It's a different realm. It's not the memory realm. Somebody said, what was it that you said? I don't know. You have to listen to it on tape. It didn't come out of my intellect. It wasn't some pre-thought. It wasn't a thought that I created and developed and can recall. It's that which comes right out of the wellspring of heaven. People, there's another realm. There's a place of the Spirit. Hallelujah. It's far beyond that of the human realm. If you want to rely upon your five senses, I'm going to tell you right now, you're never going to move in the sense of God, in the senses of the Spirit. This is my heart. I love being the place where he dwells. I love being this living sacrifice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love being the temple. I love this life of being a sacrifice, well-pleasing, a temple, Lord, where you can dwell. Wow. Where the incense rises as an offering to you. Where this holy union is felt. Where the Spirit of the Lord overshadows and controls me. Oh, God, I love dwelling in you. Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, Father, God and Father, Father God to me, Spirit, Holy Spirit, Spirit of the Lord. I love this life of being a sacrifice, well-pleasing, a temple, Lord, where you can dwell. Come on, people, can you hear me? Can you hear the pleasant thing that God has called us to? Hang on to your money, you're going to need it. Hang on to your house and the fashion of your life. It's all you're ever going to have. As for me, I forsake it all for the purpose of his will, to have him, possess him. For in, I have no one in heaven but you, Lord. I have no one in heaven but you, Lord. And all my delights in the earth are in you. Oh, that this moving of the Spirit would turn your heart back to God. Would turn your heart unto the Lord, where you begin to seek his presence and seek his presence forevermore. And you no longer hold tightly unto yourself to preserve yourself, to take care of yourself, to wonder what shall I eat or wherewith shall I be clothed. But instead, the kingdom of God captivates your very being. The will of the Father is what you live for. This life of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Montananea, I tell you, the abiding place ministry will be that which God called it to be. I'm going to tell you, God loves you. He's giving you opportunity after opportunity. He's giving you call after call. He's brought to you the best of the ministries throughout the earth. He's brought to you on a silver platter all that you could want, all that you could have in terms of being helpers of your faith. But it is your will that must decide whether or not you'll obey God and walk with him. And step into the opportunity that he has provided for you to have. Hallelujah. To bow your knee to his will, to recognize this is his voice. This isn't something that you can sit and process and wonder whether or not you agree or whether or not it makes sense to you. This is that which you're supposed to tremble over because it shakes the earth. Hallelujah. The mountains and the hills flee before the presence of his voice. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that you turn our hearts, oh God. That you turn our hearts, oh God, in your mercy and your love. That you cause us, oh God, to see that there aren't compromises, oh God, that there is no holding on to worldly and earthly interests, that we, being risen with you, Lord Jesus, seek those things which are above. We don't put affections upon this earth. No interest here. Sutalama pakia. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for strengthening us in our inner being so we can get this. Pitalabos. Pitalabos susti. Thank you, Jesus. Murasandala de kishtiti. Murasandala de kishtish. Murasandala. Ha. Oh, my gosh. Manani. Ha. I just bow my knee. And begin to offer that sacrifice. Praise. I just bow my knee. I bow my will. I cry to God. Oh God, bend me. Lord, teach me. I'll now listen. I will obey. I'll walk with you, oh God. I'll do exactly what you say. I'll go where you lead me. I'll be kept by your power. I'll keep myself too. Ha! I'll set nothing evil before my face, O God, but seek rather yours only. Hallelujah. Hambakalasia. Ha rabana kita de deshti. Manda de deshti. Mananda de deki and de dana de shapona da. Halamande de sti abedananda yiki kananoshi. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ha munda de deshia tada. Handa de deki. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Father is bringing and, as it were, turning this thing to that moment and time of confrontation. He's bringing it and turning it to the point of an absolute decision. And those who are going to walk with him and be his witnesses in the earth, who are going to move by his spirit and move by his word and move by his power. That's why God, the Spirit of the Lord, is crying out. And everybody who's hearing the voice of the Lord is hearing it. Hearing God call us to a place of separation unto himself. A place of holiness, but not defining holiness like many people do religiously, a place of intimacy, of being in the inner sanctum of the holies of holies with him. Beholding his face, touching the realm of divine power, touching the realms of glory, understanding the empowerment that is entrusted to us to be able to build up ourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. The entrustment of the spiritual growth and development that comes as we begin to pray with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and also pray out of that realm of the understanding that God then begins to speak through us by prophecy and by revelation. And it's not something that just happens once a month or once every other month or whatever, it's some, or every other week. It's something that's going on and being developed every day, and it's becoming stronger, and it's laying a hold upon him, and it's there in that place that we begin to understand where we're making wrong choices, where things of this world have hold upon our hearts, where our own interests have gripped our decision making process, where our own ideas rule our mind. Oh, there in the revelation, Father, then of his presence and fellowship and intimacy with him, suddenly begin to understand God's thoughts from human thoughts. The things which Jesus Christ is saying, the Holy Ghost is teaching and ministry, versus those things that the world and the social structure around us places demand upon us and demands us bow our knee. Bow our knee. Give our time. Oh, but God's people are going to shake off that. That bond, that chain. Hallelujah. And Father is going to begin to cause us to move in the realms of faith. That we begin to step into what he's called us to be as the church. You know, I look at the Mormons and I think, my goodness, in the realms of deception, many, many respects, but it's a false thing. They live out the dream of the church, lending to many nations and not borrowing. And it just started with a small group of people. that we're totally devoted. Well, look at what, you know, the human mind hooked up with the with demon power resulted in. Oh, what would happen if we hooked up with the mind of Christ with Holy Ghost power?
Jesus.
Yes, Lord Jesus. He's talking about how these accurate words of knowledge are familiar spirits. Well, then where is the real acting of the word of knowledge? Because that word of knowledge that people are given that does in many respects look like a familiar spirit. My goodness, look at the power of it. Look at the word of it. Look at the accuracy of it. Then where is the real thing at? Where's the real thing at? Where has God got an opportunity to express the reality of His glory and His power? I want to give Him an opportunity in my life. And I'm telling you tonight how you can give Him an opportunity in your life. And that is radical change. The only way God's going to get an opportunity in your life is when you no longer live. And that's a decision that you're constantly making as you hold on to your life, or you decide whether you're going to lose it and have His, or hold on to yours. Whether you're going to deny yourself so the Spirit of the Lord can lead you and guide you. Motosatikalana. I'm going to wrap this up here in John chapter 14. Jesus says it again. He says, believe. Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. Listen to the mind of the Spirit. Listen how you and I can walk in the mind of the Spirit. How you and I can walk in the mind of Christ. How you and I can speak as the oracles of God is recognizing first and foremost, hallelujah, the indwelling power of the living God, that Christ Jesus is in us, that the Father lives and dwells in us. It is second, a consecration to not speaking our own stuff and having our own opinion. Oh, mosateri bikista la makutatina bakaya. And this is who we're fashioning our life after. This is who we're conforming to. Jesus is showing us how it works, how intimacy works, how the display of the power of God works. Believe me that I'm in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe me just for the work's sake. It's the works that prove it. It's the works to declare the indwelling. It's the works that Father is most interested in. It's this authority over unclean spirits to cast them out. It's this authority over sicknesses and diseases to heal them and to cure them, to set free the captives, to destroy every work of the devil.
Amen.
Truly I tell you, he that believes on me will have the same indwelling. Will have the same ability to speak not after their own mind and after their own thinking, but to literally speak the words of the Father that dwells in them. Amen. These works that these, I tell you truly, anyone who believes these works, these, and we're talking about the exploits of divine power that causes the crippled to walk again, the deaf to hear, the mute to speak, the blind to see, because this is the context in which Jesus is revealing it in.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There was a work that Jesus came to finish. He came to finish the work of the Father. That was the salvation work. These are the works and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power to bring the gospel message, the light to shine in a dark place, the revelation of God's love to all lost humanity. These are the works. This is the only way it happens. That's what Paul said. I came and fully preached the gospel from Jerusalem to Illyricum with signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
This is what we must demand.
Yes, amen.
And there's a change of our behavior in our responses to God to have it.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus goes on. And he says, and I'll just wrap it up with this. Expresses over and again this wonderful blessing. But you've heard me say so many times, because, I mean, the Lord has captivated my heart with these verses of Scripture. And when the Lord captivated my heart with them, I looked around, I was wondering, well, why haven't people in my life emphasized these things? Why has it somehow been one of the minor messages, as it were, being declared, when It should be the primary description of the will of God and the manifest presence of Jesus being revealed in our life. When we begin to read verses 17 through 23. Because Jesus is just bringing this thing from the expression of his own life into the expression of our life. He's saying, this is what I've done. This is how I've done it. Now I'm going to tell you, this is how you're going to do it. You're going to do the same thing. This is how it's going to happen with you to have ultimately the same exact result. And he said again and again and again and again. And it became the very central focus of his ministry from the time he was baptized of John in the Jordan until the time that he was last seen among them and taken up into the clouds. As it's recorded in Acts 1:5 and Acts 1:7-8. John truly baptized you with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. So you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Then shall you be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Here he is. He's showing the transference of all that he did into the life of those who will believe and walk with him, who will lose their life to live his life. So here's the proof of whether or not you and I have lost our lives. I have proofs. You need to have them too. I have proofs. I've stepped into the revival, which is the means of turning back unto God to function in that which he has already given. It is the turning to that inheritance that is ours, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Not word of knowledge, word of wisdom, discerning of spirits, working of miracles, gifts of healing. In the midst of the church, in the midst of the church. Yes, we want them outside, but it's in the midst of the church. How is it that every one of you hath the tongue? Every one of you hath an interpretation. Every one of you hath a revelation. You may all prophesy one by one. Look at the flow of the Holy Ghost and the community of the church, but it doesn't happen outside of that divine connection of the flowing forth of the Spirit of the Lord from our heart and from our passions, from the depths of our being, from our emotions and our affections and our passions. You have to get hooked up with God in the inner depths of your being and quit loving other stuff so deeply. Because he will not abide there. I have no one in heaven but you, Lord. And you my only desire and delight in all the earth. It has to come that way. You have to deal with your gods, your treasures, your trust, your other things that make you happy, that bring you joy, that bring you delight. Have you any other in heaven? Have you any other delights in the earth? This is, where is your treasure? Where is your love? Where is your passion? Where is your heart? God will not allow mixed affections. He will not allow it. He will not allow it. Because all it is a pollution of his life, a desecration of that which is holy and sacred. And we're going to have to get it. The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of truth is here to show us so that we get it. But we have to be willing to hear him and listen. Because if we're not careful, we're gonna tell ourselves a lie and believe it. We're gonna buy into deceptions at various different levels that will create spiritual blindness. And I don't care how smart you are, deception has no logic to it. Has no logic to it. Very bright people are fully deceived and cannot hear. They cannot hear. They can say it, you can read it to them, but they cannot understand it. The beautiful thing about conversion is that the Lord blesses us with the ability to have eyes that can see, ears that can hear, and hearts that can understand. But can those hearts become hardened? Can those eyes become blind? Can those ears become deaf? Absolutely, shown again and again where people refuse to obey God and move with him and begin to despise his servants and despise his prophets and despise his anointing and his anointed ones. It's true. It happens, repeats itself over and again in history. Love the anointing. Love his servants. Honor his servants. Isaiah the prophet said that you want to get into the blessings of God, you start calling those who are anointed of the Lord honorable. You start honoring them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Dealing properly with the sacred of God, sacred things of God. Come on now. It's not hard here, people, to walk with God. It's just a matter of you having to say enough of you. And people have idolized themselves. They've exalted themselves above God and have not seen it nor known it nor understood it, because they turned their heart from hearing the word, understanding the word of God, because they turned their ear from hearing the word of God, because they refused to be corrected. They refused to be rebuked. They refused to live under his authority. So his house becomes a rebellious house. As the prophets of old said to Israel, so it is again. It is again. History repeats itself. We fall after the same manner of unbelief. Praise God for repentance. Praise God that we can turn back. Praise God that we can get things right. Hallelujah. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another parakletos, helper, leader, guide, comforter, mentor, interpreter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the spirit of the truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him. Interaction with the world will keep you from being able to understand the spirit of truth and receive him. And there are many displays of the interaction of the world, the spirit of the world. Understand this. Here are the Pharisees stand there in all of their holy, separated, unto God clothing, with their devotion day in, day out to the word of God, fasting twice a week, living in prayer, living in the devotion of reciting the word of God. And he says to them, you are the incarnation of the world. I am the incarnation of God. It basically brings it right down in a very powerful theological summary, biblical summary. You are the incarnation of the world. When you look at them, people, they were in the right religion, doing exactly in every pretense from the outward observation. If someone was critiquing them and taking notes and analyzing them and observing them and building evidence and argument for how they live, they would be ultimately concluding they're doing everything that God said to Moses for them to do. God told Moses for them to do. That would be the conclusion in the court by all eyewitnesses. Jesus says, you are the incarnation of the world. Uh-oh. You and I better have some more valid proofs. Because you're playing games with your eternity. You're playing games if you're not interested in valid truth, if you're not interested in reality, you're playing games with your eternity. I'm gonna have what God said. I'm going to understand the price that he commands us to pay. You lose your life. Now I'm going to make sure that I don't interpret that to serve my own interest. That I understand it exactly raw and real, like he presented it and like he demonstrated it.
Amen.
Come on now.
Yes, amen.
Come on now, people.
Amen.
Let's just understand it this way. I promise you, there are many of you tonight, and I pray all of you, you're going to be radically changed after this
amen.
Night.
Yes.
I promise you.
Yes.
I promise you,
amen.
The enemy is not going to be able, he's not going to have wiggle room to play the games anymore in your spirit.
Amen.
You're going to have a responsiveness and a yieldedness to God where God says to do it, you just total abandonment, you'll do it.
Amen.
He says, give it to me first, you'll just give it to him.
Amen.
He says, go wash in the pool of Siloam, you're going to go wash in the pool of Siloam. He says, come walk on the water with me, you're going to walk on the water with him. He tells you to go to the other side, you're going to go to the other side. You're not going to say, well, it's a storm right now, can we wait till tomorrow and argue with him or give him some kind of instruction or reason. You're going to recognize God says to do it now because his purpose, I'm going to honor God. There's something in it to do it now. He doesn't need my advice.
Amen.
Because we want to make it different, but it isn't different. It isn't different. He sent another one, the Holy Ghost, just like he was with the disciples, the Holy Spirit. In the same manner, God is with us now. And we're arguing with him and wanting to walk after our own understanding and mind and way and will. It's going to stop. And it's going to stop. God's going to have a people that says no more. He's going to have people. He's going to have a remnant so that his voice can sound out to all the world. Hallelujah. I will not leave you comfortless. And rather, I forgot, I didn't read the rest of this. It does not see him nor know him, but you know him, and he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you without a paraclete. I will not leave you without a helper. I will not leave you without a mentor. I will not leave you without a guide. I will not leave you without an interpreter. I don't want to explain and show you all these things. I will come to you.
Amen.
Yet a little while and the world sees me no more, but you will see me. And because I live, you shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in the Father, that you are in me and I am in you. He is transferring the whole work of divine power and authority, the means to have the proof right over to you and me. The same proofs that produces the works. Have you ceased from your own works? Have you entered into his rest, having ceased from your own works, to now enter into the works of God? To no longer live your life, to live his life. To no longer call it after your own mind and thinking, but to cast that mess down. Say, Lord, I value being able to have the word of knowledge above the knowledge of men. I value to have the discerning of spirits rather than my own insights and conclusions. I value the mind of the Spirit and the mind of Christ to be able to speak by the word of revelation and by the word of authority and prophecy more than anything about what my own opinions might come up with. My own bright ideas. Oh. By reason of his intellect. By reason of his brightness. By reason of his own being impressed. His own narcissism. Of staring at himself in the mirror. His heart was turned against God. We're talking about Satan. Ezekiel chapter 28. I don't have nothing like that. I don't have nothing like that. We don't want to have anything like that. It's not something that we can do of ourselves for ourselves. It's something the Holy Ghost alone can come and teach us. And praise God, he's here to teach us. But he's going to respond to our willingness to submit ourselves to him. To say, Lord, I'm not going to move. I'll stay right here. I'll be there. I go where you lead me. I live by you. I want to live by you. Tell them and get up in the morning and say, Lord, Holy Ghost, I don't know how to do this. Because you don't. Lord, I don't know how to do this, but I want to live by you. I don't know how to do this, but I want to be led by you. I don't know how to do this, but I want to walk in you. I want to move in you. I want to hear you. I want to understand you. I want to be sensitive to your movings. Because you can only pray that way because it's coming because you want it. Otherwise, it's make-believe. You got to write that down. Well, could you say it again, Pastor? Let me write that down. No, because that ain't real. That sense not real. It's got to come out of here because you want that. That's something that you pray because you want that. It's been distilled in your spirit because it is the word of God. It's what God said, and you want that.
I want this, Lord.
When you want that, those prayers come out. That asking comes out of you. That's real prayer.
Amen. Huh?
It's not make-believe. That's real prayer. That's not God. Ghost, I don't know how to do this, but I want you. And that's the meaning of tomorrow. That is the meaning of tomorrow. That's the only reason for tomorrow to exist. That's it. If you make tomorrow about any other reason than for you to learn how to walk with God and live out God's life and live out what Jesus Christ purchased for you at Calvary, you miss the whole picture. You have wasted your day and perhaps wasted your life. Tomorrow's all about the life of Jesus Christ being revealed in a lost and dying world.
Yes.
Tomorrow's all about you and I being established in his way. Yes. Because he liberated us and set us free from the powers of darkness so we could understand how to walk with him throughout the ages, to step into things that go beyond all that we can think or ask or imagine. I have none in heaven but you, Lord. Who do you have in heaven? None but him. And there he is at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for us. Living to make intercession for us. The Holy Spirit knowing exactly where our weaknesses are. And he's making intercession with groanings which cannot be uttered. He wants us to get this right. He's desperate to see this established in our life. Praise God for his mercy. He that knows the mind of the will of God is the one that makes the intercession. All we got to do is start listening. Huh? All we got to do is start pleading. All we got to do is start asking. All we got to do is get real with God. All we got to do is start looking at the reality and stop making it, fit our own description of what we think God wants. Because as soon as we start saying, here it is. This is the reality of what Father wants. And that ain't happened in my life. It's going to be, and there is a right heart. It doesn't produce a sense of failure. In condemnation. it produces a brokenness and a submission and a hunger and a thirst, because no demon can interfere with God's word. If there's another thing going on, that's a demonic stronghold. That's a demonic power. You've been swept away by the pride of life. The pride of life was the entrance for the enemy to be able to do that, twist God's word around and beat you up with it. And ultimately, you get all overwhelmed and going to give up and feel like such a failure and can't ever get it right, can't ever do anything right. Demonic. So demonic. So imprisoned. No, God's word produces this hunger, the response. What you just said is what I want to be. Yeah. Just about everybody in this place here tonight, you know, you've been blessed with the ability to hook up with the Holy Ghost, the language of the Spirit. And what Father wants to do with that and where He wants to take you with that, you're good. You're good to go. All you've got to do is be willing to go. All you got to do is be willing to pack up and go. Move in with Him in every dimension. Jesus says, "He that has my commandments, my saying, what I decree, hallelujah, and keeps them, this is the one who loves me." And my, has He laid it down in John up to this point. And if I went to the highlights of that which He said in John, you know, there, it rings out with us losing our life to see the very love and power and glory of God revealed through us. He says, that's the one who loves me, and the ones who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will come and manifest myself to him. And that's a whole bunch of love and a whole bunch of glory, and I'm in it, and I want it. And that's what Paul's saying. And I count it all but dung that I may win Christ. See, he realized the contrast. He realized, if I hang on to that, if I hang on to all that I learned at Gamaliel's feet, if I hang on to all of my prestige and all the things that I have in concerning what I've been able to do, what I've been able to develop and who I am and all of my laurels, I can't have Jesus. I've got to understand what it is. It's that which is going to keep me back from him. And I count it as nothing. As nothing. For I have suffered the loss of all things. Listen to him. Because all he's doing is responding to what Jesus said. If you keep my commandments, you must lose your life. I have suffered the loss of all things. Hear it. Hear it. Because I don't know that there's a lot of people that's ever done this. They're not willing to do it. I have suffered the loss of all things and count it but dung. And that is radical. That is radical. I like to get graphic with this because I don't think people get graphic enough. Okay? Think about it just before you flush the toilet. I know that is crude, but it really helps you to understand what you've been all boasting about and what you've been all held back by. And how you will learn to hate your life in this world if you let the Holy Ghost teach you. It will have that kind of contrast to you. And until you let the Holy Spirit show you, it won't have that contrast. It won't. It'll be something you reluctantly or even reluctant to let go of because it's still shiny. And it ain't shiny. That's deception. Praise God for the working of the facilities. I praise God for them. I praise God for them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I want to just impress you. I want to impact you. It's not about bathroom talk.
Right.
I want to impact you. I want to impress you with the reality of what God the Holy Spirit will do in truth and reality to make this thing so distinct in your spirit. You got to want it. We have to want these things. So I'll come manifest myself to you. I'm saying, okay, Lord, I understand this. Can you see him dancing around? Jumping up and down, saying, I'm your prize. I'm your prize. I'm your shield. I'm your benefactor. I'm your exceeding great reward. I'm your prize. Can you see him? He's saying, and all I want is you to love me with all your heart, with all your soul. All I want you to understand is how different I am from the world, and you can't hold on to the world and have me. You can't. I want you to understand how way beyond I am to anything that you know about your existence. And you can't have all be compromised with all that you think you understand about life and have the true life and the existence that I pay for you to have. And he's waiting for somebody to risk it all and trust him and step over that threshold. And men do not want to because they're trapped in the perception of their own thinking about what they believe life to be. And there, Satan works his game and defines his words, creates his doubts and his illusions and his shadows. God calls us to break free and come stand in the light of his presence. Where that darkness can't work.
Thank you, Lord.
People, we need to flee from the wrath that is to come and lay hold on eternal life. I'm telling you right now, the gangplank is down and God is calling and saying, this is the ark of safety. If any man will come, if any man, anyone, if any man will come, if anyone, anyone, let him deny himself. Take up his cross, come in and imitate me. He's calling. He's crying out. You can't mix it with me. You can't mix up what you think and what you understand and how life and existence and this world has defined things for you and your perceptions. You cannot. You cannot. It will not work. It's so far beyond all of that. If any man will come, the gangplank is down. Come into the ark of safety. I love all of humanity. Come, obey me, just come. Come, you'll get it later. You can't understand it now, just come. Come stand in the light and you will learn. You'll get it later. I'll show you, I'll give you revelation, I'll give you insight, I'll give you spiritual understanding and the knowledge of the Lord. Hallelujah. Your eyes will be open, you'll be able to see, you'll get it later. Right now, with total abandonment, you're going to have to risk everything, and trust me, you're going to have to understand you cannot hold on to your own trust. You can't hold on to your own life, and trust me and have my life. That's the contrast, people. This is what God is saying. And verse 23 rings out with such glory that there's not a one of us that should not just say, In confidence that what God is saying is true, that he's not a liar, that this is really ours. This is him jump. Verse 23 is God jumping up and down saying, I'm your prize. I'm your shield. I'm your exceeding great reward. It's him saying to us, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him, and we will make our abode in him. So that you may be able to say, the words which I speak, it's not of myself, but the Father speaks in me. The work which I do. If you don't believe me for my word's sake, then believe me for my work's sake. For it is the Father that does the works in me. I'm an ambassador, witness of heaven. My citizenship is in heaven. My conversation is in heaven. I'm seated in the heavenly realm. I no longer live, it's Christ Jesus that lives. Hallelujah. I live in him, he lives in me. This life that I now live by the faith of I live in the flesh by the faith of the Son of God. This life that I now live in the flesh, this earthly existence, I live by the faith of God, who gave himself for me so that I get to give myself to him. Mm. Come on, it's the celebration. It's the wedding. Come on. It's the party. Hallelujah. It's the joy. It's the dancing around. I'm in him and he's in me. He's for me and I'm for him. His banner over me is love. I'm my beloved's and he is mine. Hallelujah. Praise God. Abiding place ministry, stand with me in a surrendered heart towards God and let Father work this work in you. Let him just listen. I'm telling you now, you could listen to me. As you yield to the Spirit of the Lord, as you respond to him in this and say, yes, God, I'll do this. I'm telling you, it gets so good because you get to step into the realms of the church and feel the mantle of his glory come upon you like a heavy heavenly cloak set upon you. I mean, when God sets that mantle on you, it's feel good from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. If you have any pain, it exits. If you lacked any peace, it exits. I mean, if you didn't have joy, you thrilled. Every cell of your body begins to celebrate. Hallelujah. And it's more. I'm not exaggerating. I'm under. See, what would be the opposite of exaggerate? It's not an understatement. I'd like to create a word here. Not exaggerate, under eight. Not exaggerate, I'm under eight. This is so much bigger. Somebody said, well, I didn't understand that. You didn't understand the other word either. You just went along with it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my servitude upon you. I'm meek and lowly. You shall find rest unto your soul. He that is entered the rest has ceased from his own works. Why? So that we can do the works of God. If any man believe, anyone believe, these works which I do shall he do also in greater works than these, because I go to my Father. Hallelujah. I'm going to send you the Holy Ghost. Abiding place ministry, we're going to do this. Now, come on. We're going to do this.
Thank you, Lord.
We're going to do this. It's not about the circumstance that you're in, the house that you live in, the job that you live in, the things that are around you. It's about the disposition of your heart and your passion. It's about the level of intimacy and interaction. It's about your willingness to listen to the Holy Spirit and say, Lord, I'll be taught of you now. It's about getting it positive instead of negative, getting excited about learning lowliness and meekness instead of being all whipped into a frenzy over it. Hallelujah. Katashaya. It's not being in doubt and unbelief and worried and concern, but in confidence and faith and boldness and certainty that God, who began this good work, he's going to do it because you're willing to walk it out with him. Hallelujah. It's trusting God, not you, having begun in the Spirit. It's only by the Holy Ghost that you can be made perfect and mature and grow. And praise God for his devotion and commitment to making it happen. If you're sick in your body tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be healed, that toe to be healed. Hallelujah. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to lay hold upon the healing, whatever it is in your part of your body, whatever it is in the realms of your spirit or your thinking, whatever it is, the things that you've been, if there's been blockades in your life, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command the blockades to go. Hallelujah. If there's been fear and torment in your life, I command that fear and torment to go in Jesus' name and never be able to return. Because he that's fearing and torments not made perfect in love. And God wants you to be made perfect in love, complete in him. Knowing and believing the love that he has for you and the commitment that he has for you that he proved at Calvary's cross. If you're watching right now by the web tonight and you have never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, get to calling right now. I mean, run to the refuge, run to the place of safety. He will in no way turn anyone out or refuse anyone who comes to him. I don't care who you are, whether you've been going to church all your life or whether you've never been to church. Tonight you can come running to Him and He will not refuse you. You can come lay hold upon the horns of the altar and say, God, I got to get this right. I've got to know You. My eternity is right now at stake. Your will and Your purpose for my life is at risk. Oh God, I'm going to lay hold on You. Hallelujah. You can never enter into the holy place until you go to the altar. Every door that leads to the house of God, first thing you see is the altar. You cannot go up the golden steps, because they're golden, they're gold. The gold steps into the place where Christ Jesus will live throughout that 1,000 years. And it's a mansion. Unless you go to the altar. You have to go to the altar. You have to go to the altar. Have to go to the altar. I have to go to the altar. I go to the I have to go to the altar. I'm gonna go to the altar. I'm gonna go to the altar. I'm gonna go outside the camp where everybody else is all upset because it's a reproach. I'm gonna go to the altar. I'm gonna bear the reproach. I'm gonna go to the altar. I'm gonna go to the altar. I'm gonna go to the altar. And then I'm gonna become an altar. If I go to the altar, the cross, I'll become an altar. You go to the altar, people, I'm going to tell you right now, to be slain. You go to the altar, become a living sacrifice. You go to the altar, just live for Him. You go to the altar, you go to the altar. To be crucified together with Christ so that we no longer live. You go to the altar there. Hallelujah. People have wanted to make calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ something less than going to the altar and being crucified with Christ to no longer live. But I tell you, that's a lie. It's a misrepresentation. And you'll never know the life. So many people have responded to a gospel message. It's not the gospel. It's another gospel. And if they would have heard it right the first time to recognize it's a loss of your life, then they would have been had a chance to get it right and experience this abundant life which they were deprived of and found themselves in religion and said, wait a minute, I didn't sign up for this. I had it better in the New Age. I had it better at this thing or that thing in Buddhism or Hinduism. Come to the altar. Hallelujah. That you may step in with the blood. There at the altar, you can grab the blood. There at the altar, you can grab the coals and put it into the censer now and begin to have the incense and the blood. But the Lord just says, all you need is the blood. I love people. I love being. I love being. A sacrifice well pleasing unto Him. A temple where He loves and delights to dwell. Jesus, the Father, the Holy Ghost. My life, I hate my life in this world. All the things that I could do or I could be or I could see or I could know. Count it as nothing. The worst of things, in fact, that I might win Jesus. Father, we come to You tonight. And we intercede and we cry out before You with this urgent prayer. Oh God, let the abiding place live before You as You ordained it. Oh God, where people step in to the signs and the wonders and display of Your power and Your life, because they no longer live, they live in You. It's no longer about themselves, it's about You, Jesus. It's about You, Jesus. It's about You, Jesus. It's about You, Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Your people, I tell you tonight, every one of you standing in this place,
Let your life become an altar. Let your life become an altar. Let your life become an altar, a place of interaction with the Father. Let your life become an altar, a place that the sweet aroma of that which is well-pleasing unto the Father is offered up before Him. Let your life become an altar, a living sacrifice to Jesus, a living sacrifice to Him. Jesus. Withhold nothing from Him. Just withhold nothing. Just consecrate it to Him. Just consecrate your life to Him. You have nothing more valuable than your life. Just start there. Some of you get thinking about other things. It's just your life. Just consecrate your life to Him. Just consecrate all that you have to Him. And let Father work all the details out later. Don't sit there and try to figure it all out. Just consecrate yourself to Him. Just let your life be an altar. He loves you. He'll work all the rest of the details out. You just get stuck in the details. What about this? What about that? What have I got to do here? What have I got to do there? No, just surrender. Just surrender. Just turn it over. Just turn it over. Just turn it over. Just come to the rest. He's calling those who are weary and heavy laden. He's not calling you to come to work. He's calling you to come to rest. He's calling you not to come get a burden, but to lose one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, He's calling you to lose your life, but He's going to give you something far better than what you're losing. Hallelujah. Oh, He's called you to sow your life, but I'm going to tell you right now, the increase and the multiplication of it, you can't even begin to fathom. I prophesy to you tonight in the name of Jesus Christ, that there is a great grace the Father will put upon your lips and a favor that He will put in your life, that you may be able to speak as the oracles of God, and the word of God would become as a sharp two-edged sword out of your mouth, that it would cause great conviction and divide and sunder heart, soul from spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And reveal the intents and the thoughts of the heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That as you begin to give yourself to God, as you begin to seek His face, as you begin to hunger out and cry out for these things which God demands, hallelujah, when you will not in any way take any other alternative approach or take any substitutes, you shall fully find and have and embrace that which God's about to do. Because I'm telling you, this is the time of the latter rain. This is the time of great miracles. The wait's over. God is calling. It's time of a mobilization. It's time now for a consecration and a commitment. No longer delay. No longer wait for another day. No longer wait for another more convenient time. Now. Now. Now in Jesus' name. This is a great thing here in this place tonight, with every person on their knees before God and every heart consecrated to Him. And I promise you, I know that the Father does not in any way take this for granted or take it lightly, but it's so valuable, precious, and meaningful to Him. And I promise you, by the authority and the promise of God, that Father surrounds you and folds you, that He will be right there in the midst of you to uphold you, that He will be there to help you in the crossroads and the challenges and the decisions that you have to make that have been able to beset you in the past, but you're going to be able to be successful. Now and in the future. Father's not willing for us to be without these things which He's commanded.
And now we demand them of ourselves. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We demand them. Hallelujah. We demand them. Hallelujah. Masapota karashika. Hallelujah. Borama mamanda de feste. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let our tongues be your quill, God. And the Holy Spirit, the ink. Write the pages of your will, Lord. Write the pages of your love. Write the pages of your life. On the tables of our heart and expressions of our faces, oh God. Signs and wonders and miracles. Demonstration of the flowing power of the Spirit of the living God. The liberation, the freedom, the passion, the expressions. Display, oh God, of your Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Mold me, break me, melt me, mold me. Make me, oh, break me, melt me, mold me, make me, Lord, break me, melt me, mold me, make me, Lord, break me, melt me. Mold me, make me, Lord, bring me, melt me, mold me, make me, Jesus, bring me, melt me, mold me, make me, I yield to you, oh God, oh Lord. Your will be done in me, oh God. Break me, melt me, mold me, make me, fashion me, oh Lord. After thy will, I totally yield to you, oh, break me. Melt me, mold me, make me, fashion me like you. Oh God, I totally yield to you, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, dear saints, we're about ready to put the church building up in Oregon. And so just reach in with us for a miracle supply of finances that we need to get it up now. We got it on the ground. Praise God. First step of the miracle's done. And basically we got all the final permissions that we needed, all final paperwork in on it. And I'm believing God that we're going to have the thing up by mid-November. We're pressing it hard. We've got, you know, God has major plans for what we're going to do in that building and the gathering of ministries that are going to be out there. And, you know, Father's just putting it all together. It keeps getting bigger. And you think, well, how is it that people are going to go out to a remote place like that? No, when the power and the glory of God is moving, people will go to the North Pole. They'll go to Antarctica. They'll go to the Sahara Desert. So the tent, we get the tent on the ground. We're getting ready to put the tent up, start having meetings there. And get the sign up. I'm going to put the tent right up, right behind where the church is actually going to be. I just see the Lord doing so many wonderful and amazing things. There is such a huge need for laborers in the kingdom, people that will run with the signs and wonders and demonstration in the Holy Ghost. And so I pray tonight that as you leave here, you'll just leave in the stillness and this quietness and this consecration and this soberness of God. And let it will turn into a divine explosion, an expression of the Holy Ghost in you. I pray that you'll let the Spirit of the Lord create within you those utterances of prayer and intercession and supplication. Those utterances of revelation and knowledge and prophecy as you go to seek His face as you're waiting on Him every day. And watch as Father takes you to a whole other dimension, display of His power and glory. Because I believe with all my heart, it's a moment in time that it's like spiritual rapid growth. To where that if you just step in and do and cooperate with God and don't define what you're going to do tomorrow based upon what you've done in the past, but say, okay, here we go. By the way, with you, Lord, I'm gonna do what Jesus did. I'm gonna do it the way Paul did it. I'm gonna do it the way God ordained it. Hallelujah. I'm gonna understand these things. They were ministered by the Spirit tonight. Hey, the beautiful thing is, if you didn't get Sunday morning's message, I'm sure that YouTube's already out. You need to get on that and listen to that. And if the YouTube's not out, let's get somebody to get it done. And let's get it posted. And then listen to this tonight. Listen. Because the Spirit of the Lord is driving home something. He speaks His word and empowers us through the spoken word. Hallelujah. To do what He's commanded. To do what He's designed and desired. Hallelujah. All we got to do is hear the word and move with faith. Let the word be mixed with faith. Let the word be mixed with that risky abandonment. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I trust that those of you who have been lavishly giving of your finances, that you're experiencing a supernatural multiplication. And if you haven't, you just wait. People think when they give, they're going to lose something. I'm telling you, that's not what God said. God said, I'm going to multiply it. There's a multiplication. Now, you must understand, I know of people who never stepped into the multiplication because they never gave in faith. everything we do in God is a moving of the of faith. It's a moving of the supernatural supply of the Holy Ghost, the jumping up and down on the inside of us, motivation from heaven. Amen. And there is a multiplication with that. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. The greatest miracle that I know of is the supply of the Holy Ghost to live the life of Jesus. What a miracle. And I pray that every one of you grab a hold of that tonight. You can live the miracle life of Jesus, and you understand anything that get in the way of that and refuse it. Just lay hold on the miracle life of Jesus, and the Holy Ghost is going to make so apparent to you the things that are in the way. You know why? It's just the way it is. Because when the lights are going on, you can see all the trash that's laying around.